idea of that. That you see, if we want to make a mark, if we must at all benefit from the political system that we have, then other people must necessarily do away with this idea, this high-headedness, this arrogance, this empty pride that I worked for him. You worked for him, so what? Do you know what others did for him? You do not know. It was just because of your poverty you followed him from village to village. Moreover, each time you went, any money he brought, you collected. Did you contribute? You didn't contribute. So how will he even remember you? So it is important that we understand the issues associated with governance. So having dwelt on that, which is the second part, it is very, very important that we discuss or share on the issue of requirements for successful participation in politics. I doubt if there is any venture at all in the world that you don't need the ABC. I doubt if there is. There is nothing. You need the ABC. Politics, you may look at it, anybody can come and do it. It is because our people have been doing it like that. That is why they come out without any reasonable gains. This is very, very important. In fact, the most critical part of our discussion with you has to do with this requirement, the third part of my paper. It's very, very important that you realize this. See, oftentimes our people have killed themselves, they have fought. This one fights for APC, that one fights for this. At the end of the day, they undo themselves. Those that benefit are there, they are drinking their tea, are doing this and that. You don't benefit anything. Why? It is because you go into politics, number one, without a vision. See, let me tell any of us, anybody at all, as an individual, as a family, as a community, as a state, as a tribe, that does not have vision, as the driving force behind his or her life, is lost. What is vision? Vision means having a mental picture of what you want in any venture you are engaged in. What do you want ultimately? What do you want? Oftentimes, other people engage in politics without vision. How? He engages in politics just because others agree, he does not. Let's take the case of the Gwandara man, for instance. I know, even the Oga seated here knows very well, he knows that the Gwandara tribe, one of the ethnic nationalities also, is nowhere close to the population of Maga in Nasarawa State. I'm sure you know. But as we speak today, they have more than 10 chiefdoms in Nasarawa State, spread across all. Why? Because they went into politics with a vision. These are definite things they want to gain in politics. Not so with Mutumi Mada. Not so. He goes into politics. Nonsense. That is what the Mada man does. So how can you benefit? But he goes with specific things in mind. Specific. I want at the end of this regime, I should have this, I should have that, and I should have that. That's all. If I'm able to succeed, so be it. At any point in time, Madaman doesn't play politics with vision. And you cannot do. See, vision in politics, it's like compass in the high sea. I've not been to the high sea, so I don't understand what it looks like. But I am told by navigators that when you get to the high seas, you will discover that you will look beyond your sight. It is water. Everywhere you are surrounded by water. And at that point in time, you discover that the place, what you already know from your local environment, the sun will come out here, set here, do this. It changes. So at that time, what do you need in order to go to your direction? It is the compass that you need. You need compass in your life as an individual. This is what I want in life. When you don't have compass, how will you organize yourself? If you go into university, for instance, that you want to have first class, it determines how you read, how you do your assignments, how you attend your lectures. So how can you play politics as a tribe without compass, without vision? This is one of the greatest challenges. And my desire is that as we go into this game of politics in 2023, it is very much around the corner. please, you must have things that you have as targets, things that you hope to achieve. And people are very wise. As we speak, we are very, very much discriminated against. We are very, very much discriminated against after our conga, outside our conga. We are called settlers, we are called this, we are called that. So the Gwadara man is wise. His vision in politics tells him, okay, look for the most important, which is what? Traditional. But Mother Man doesn't have as base of mother people. Can you look around to see? I often say, and I'm not joking, that we have not had visionary leaders even in our conga. The so-called contest that you have with your neighbors has persisted largely because vision was not brought into the journey. That's all. The so-called contest, if people saw the future 100 years ahead, 50 years ahead, they would have brought projects or programs in place that will make this area to be your own. Nobody can contest it. Did they do it? So you play politics for what? Politics without vision? Politics without target about concrete things that you want to attain? And what my advice is to the youth is that don't look for things that will promote your interest as an individual. See, collective strength is always stronger, better. Because it is when your tribe is feared, when the tribe can cause people to lose election or win, then they will respect you. So if you are wise in politics, struggle for your tribe to be strong rather than you as an individual. That is not the issue. There have been situations among Mada people where you are told that this person went there and negotiated with others and left his tribe. One of those moments was this governorship team. When the governorship aspirants, we met them, and what did they tell us? They all sat down and agreed that we will go for the governorship ticket. Then one or two went behind and negotiated for senatorial. That is it. So this is what we are saying. See, you must make sure, I'm now talking about the second factor that is important in politics, which is unity of purpose. The moment you undermine my interest, you are undermining yours. Because nobody will respect you. Nobody will respect you if your tribe is not strong. See, the mere fact that it is politics means that it is something that is group-oriented. It's not an individual thing. It's not. And so the stronger your group is, the more benefits or resources you extract from this. Because they will fear you. If we don't do them this, they will injure us. So they will do with you. So Madama doesn't play politics with unity of purpose. Everybody pursuing. How can you succeed as individuals? It is a collective venture. And my charge to us is that always play politics that will strengthen your group. Because it is that group umbrella that will give you what you want. When they fear your tribe, whatever you want, they will give you. Okay, let successive governments in Nasarawa State, let them refuse to give you Uganda. You get what I'm saying? Whether we like it or not, from 1999 up to now, though the regimes have not, they don't favor Igon, but they have always carried them along. That's the truth about it. Because of what? That's why so Jimana Zambo 5 years are there. So they give them. Why can't you build your system to be like that? See, does any of you own any political party? It is unfortunate. I'm so disappointed. Do you own a party? This person knows, the typical Hausa man, where his tribal interest is his party. As you are seated here today, my disappointment is that you people are struggling about your party. See, when you have won elections and the idea, they will turn to their tribes. They will turn to their primary constituencies. And that is why we experience the situation that we have to do. So you must have unity of purpose. You are pursuing common goal. Because when our tribe is strong, then you see individuals amongst us can find expression of our interests. But as long as our tribe, one of them said, yes, Ishi Koboko Igoti na Abazanchi. Yes, that is it. So what makes you, not law registration, not voters? Ah, Munyi,
APC, that's what Samoa advantage, said they are Hutu. Just imagine. And you claim you are educated. You claim you are an elite. Who has told you? See, the net effect of this is the lack of employment in the Kungama University many years. Because when you are not represented there, was it back Aiki? When they get opportunities, they are giving their people, they are not giving you. Because you don't belong. So please and please, it is important that in our march to greatness in politics, we must give pride of place to what we call unity of purpose. We must give pride of place to unity of purpose, which means the pursuit of the interests of the tribe as a whole, because it is that tribal umbrella that will make people to be afraid of you and give you whatever you want in politics. So it is very, very important that we do that. Apart from that, economic and financial muscle. And I've often challenged us. Sorry, let's be real now. Please, President, show me any madam that has two trailers. Show me any that has two petrol tankers. And you think you should not be weeping? Huh? It is unfortunate. Everywhere across the world, those that have the financial resources, economic muscle, they are the ones that drive the affairs of parties. They're the ones. So if you want to benefit from a political arrangement, you must be able to make contributions that will change. See, the moment you give money, every day they will be coming to your house as if you are the owner of the party to take direction. Who do we give this position to? Who do we give? So, mother people must take note that the issue of financial and economic muscle is all the more very, very important in your march to greatness. You can sit down. He knows those great guys, the Apollos and so on, among the Igbira people. Yes, the one, there is, I've forgotten whether it's Sule or what, that was given this contract, Panda Abuja Road. Yes. They can give the governor 200 million. Tomorrow, when they want their person to be appointed Speaker of the House of Assembly, they will give him because he contributed. So you must know that you can't benefit in this system without adding value to it. You must first add value before you extract resources therefrom. And this is almost totally absent. You go for a campaign, money to buy Akamu, you want from him. Money to buy Kose, you want from him. In fact, it appears as if you are attracted to follow him to that place, because at the end of the day, he will give you 300 naira. And any day he does not give, Zagi. Then the politician will always tell you, Aina Seya. So what will you now say? What will you now say? So it is important that as you take steps in this journey, you must make contributions. They can be intellectual, they can be economic, always makes the difference, economic. Finances, you give finances to change the course of events. Yes. Well, that person is giving 200,000, then a money bag comes in. How much will you need to you? Okay, I will give them 500,000. You mean when he's there, he will forget you? He will hardly forget you. So it is important that our people do the needful so as to acquaint themselves with their nitty-gritty of this. Then this possession of good psychology of individuals and groups. I am, in fact, in this regard, I am so disappointed. This is the tribe I come from, and it is unfortunate. Almost all, even including the youths, they are very, very poor in this regard. Very, very poor. See, before you benefit, that is why I always tell women, see, if you want to enjoy your husband or your friend, study him and know him. The moment you know him, the moment you know what will make him happy, people will be saying, you have taken him to Malam. Well, like, there is no Malam. The Malam is you have a very good psychology of that person. So how many mother people? How many of them? Study the system. You recall the great late Dedere, Marafan Dedere. Was he great? The very day, the very moment We were told Abdullahi Adamu took him to Obasanjo, Almighty Obasanjo, and he mesmerized Obasanjo. That very day, he got a contract nearly just few thousands away from 1 billion naira. Marafandere. What did he do? Obasanjo was looking for somebody who would give him spiritual power. And here was a person that Abdullahi Adamu was excitedly introduced to him. Then when they went, he removed his head and kept one side. Then it was only his then Obasanjo clapped and said, this is what. How did Marafandere end up? He ended up, he was chairman of PDP in Nasarawa State. And then Obasanjo appointed him chairman, National Program on Immunization, that is into billions, hundreds of billions of naira. Tell me. Because he read, he understood. Understanding the psychology of people is critical. Many people just think they just talk anything. You don't study a person, you don't do. So just like some women, because they have already married, they think the husband will not chase another woman again. And then they dress anyhow, isn't it? So just like the madam one talking anyhow, he addresses, he does not know the language to use. See, there are people, if you study them well, they are so power drunk that if you understand them, they may want in the public, you go and bend down and greet them. Some, they want you pull your shoe and believe you me, whatever you want, they will do. Just pull your shoe. There was one in Garapu. Anytime, no matter how educated you were, and you just pulled your shoe, when he was far off and you were almost crawling on the ground, he would do anything to defend your political interest. Is that not simple psychology? Mother people, why can't you use simple psychology to study individuals, to study systems, so as to get what you want? Why? What is wrong? So psychology of individuals is important, which is followed by knowledge of the subject. I'm sure all of us that followed what Obama did. Obama mesmerized. Obama, anytime he stood to speak, he weakened everybody. He attracted everybody, and before they knew, they were supporting him. So if you want to succeed in this game, for people to say, Shilela Mubashi, secretary in a party, a state, this and that, you must be knowledgeable. Anytime I'm a Ghanaian party, such a within your fingertips. They want this person there, you have the details. They want this and that. You have. They will certainly deal with you. So for you to succeed, you must possess this knowledge as well. It is very, very important. Then the use of force. It is unfortunate that as we speak, it is unfortunate. Let me tell all of us, life is a war. Life is a war. And I have not seen anybody who goes to such a war to harvest honey. You go to harvest honey and you think the bees, see, it is a war, you fight a war. So if you are fighting a war, are you going there to go and joke? More often than not, the nature of Nigerian politics requires that you use force to achieve what you want. That is absent in my life. That is absent. That is absent. Why do politicians raise talks? Where they will not win, they make sure so that they can do. Do you use that? I teach political science. I am not supposed to tell you this one, but the truth is, in Africa and Nigeria in particular, the truth is that you cannot avoid the use of talks, the use of force in order to achieve your goal. You may use it. So you must, if you are going into this game, you must be familiar with all the tricks. There are so many ways of rigging. So you must be very, very familiar. Otherwise, just forget. You are just wasting your time. How I wish you will be able to harness your thinking together so that you don't use it against yourselves. The Hausa man, I live with them. We were born with them and we still live with them and we understand. They will pretend as if the whole world will come to an end. Give you the impression that they are divided. It is a lie. When they do that, you say, you pick him to represent you. You pick another Hausa to represent. When they go there, they just agree. You just write figures.
favoring their candidate and they vote. What is it? So you must be wise as you go into this game. But I am saying, wisdom seems to dictate in the politics that we are in that the use of force must be there. So if I want to tell you the truth, I must attune your mind, I must address your, draw your attention to that. That you cannot. Bazaka here, Chire Zuma, without force, it is not possible. Mind you, in all developing countries, politics is business, it's not for service. Politics is business. It's a business venture. You invest to reap. And so if you are investing and somebody is coming, yes, sir, what do? You clear sort one. And that is what legitimizes in quote the use of force in politics. So you cannot take that away. You cannot. Unfortunately, that is not what happens. And then power of persuasion, we have already said that. Yeah. Then this very, very important but negligible aspect. Let me tell you, if you want to contest election here, and your next door neighbor, for now, this is my next door neighbor, he is opposed to me, and I know somebody in 3 million miles away from here that he listens to him. What do I do? You go to that person. Many other people do this kind of thing. You must network with the stakeholders, with the gatekeepers. Every system has gatekeepers. Every system has gatekeepers. Those that control the course of events in every system, all of them, there are those that keep. I remember the case of this late Solomon Kogi in Jamaa. How did he win his election? His wife was, I don't know whether she's still alive. His wife, let me use his words, related to Jonajan. And Jonajan was close to Solomon Lab. So how did they do it? He used Jonajan. Jonajan, his wife, took her husband Solomon Kogi to this. And then he took them to Solomon Lab. And then Solomon Lab just sat there as the national chairman of PDP that time and requested the people in Jamaa, local government, to give him the chairmanship ticket. But I've been the Kagoma, because Kagoma is the majority tribe in Jamaa local government. But I've been the Basuiba. The gatekeepers have already decided that Gassama, this is what it is. How many other people think that networking is very critical? Gatekeepers of a system, they are the ones that will decide. Whatever I say, whatever you say here may not even mean anything. Does Dangote have influence in the politics of Nasarawa State? Does the Sultan have influence in the politics of Nasarawa State? Does Obasanjo have? Does this and that? So that means that if you are a wise politician and you want to get whatever you want, go there and get it. See, there have been moments, the Koro in my local government, how did they get their chiefdom? How did they get their district? Leave the Yasquwa man forever, Koro will not get. The ADC to Dr. Gambola Rawa, when she was minister and then VC of University of Abuja, he did the miracle for them. We are talking of the importance of network in achieving your goals in politics. It appears from all indications that we think that it is something that on our own we can do and be successful, and that is why we have the rating low. And I want to say that indeed, if that is our this thing, we will not make any reasonable impact. So just as our elders have not made any meaningful impact in our political match, they have not made. Because to make meaningful impact means scholarship award, your people are there. Infrastructure like road, like electricity, like water, you have it all over. That is an indication that indeed that you are benefiting from the system. So I am saying, yes, they have participated, but they have participated as passive people. They have participated as those that work for those who enjoy the system. That is what I'm saying. And to that extent, our benefits from the system have been very, very minimal.
This leads us to the issue of the role of the youths in changing this situation. From all indicators, see, I can reel out statistics upon statistics. See, as we speak today, quote me anywhere. You have the highest concentration of academics of Mada extraction in Nasarawa State University. There is no university in Nigeria because the Mada people have not read. They have not. So you have the highest concentration there. It may interest you to know painfully, painfully, that as we speak, only one Mada is a female lecturer in the university. But even then, she's married to an outsider, the person she has married. And then when tribes are talking, you talk. See, if you observe trends in the world at all, you know that there is increasing shift towards equalization of opportunities for women. So a tribe that is conscious, a tribe that knows what it is doing, will give pride of place to the training of women. As we speak, that is not the case. Is it not a shame? A shame. I don't even want to talk about it. It pains me that these are realities that to tell you, to tell me that we are nowhere. That is why I'm bringing it. So how? So for us to change this negative state of affairs, in order for us to reverse this situation that is very, very unfavorable, and to empower us, to make us tomorrow to be like China, to be like this, to be like that, it is important that we play these critical roles. In the first place, the youth must, whether they like it or not, make efforts to serve as agents of change. See, the way this tribe is constituted at the moment, you don't know the danger. See, I have stayed with the Afo people and many other tribes. I've stayed with them. And they use just one very simple trick. Simple. You may think it is foolish, but I tell you, there is great. Not be considered. How do you expect I from, you call us diasporas, how will you expect each time we work for you to make you deputy governor, to make you the senator, the moment you go there you forget about us? It is great wisdom to extend your hands of fellowship to your brothers across, because when you need them tomorrow to contest the gubernatorial election or whatever, they are already established here. They will represent you there. But the choice of injustices among sexes, men and women, among the zones, districts of Mada, I have had, see, it was a tug of war. We had to convince a number of people. Why do you want to form parallel MDA with this one? That anytime positions come, they are always talking of, they have marginalized them in Mada West. That is what they said. And they are serious about it. See, your neighbors who are just waiting tomorrow, it is very easy for them to penetrate. And that was why those tribes there, in the Afro tribe in Nasarawa, they came up with that wisdom line that, see, let's rotate this position so that we will continue to enjoy it. When it is in this zone today, tomorrow it is there. Tomorrow it is there. Is that not serving their purpose? See, there is no election. The local government is there in Nasarawa. There is no election. So they sue on their own, sue Yada because of the arrangement they have made. You are existing amongst hawks, among lions, among wolves. You must build durable systems that can withstand the wear and tear. Namutas, you must be able to do that. You cannot
How can you afford to match? There are no women. How many doctors, women doctors, do you have? Doesn't this one prick your conscience? It should prick your conscience. You don't have, and you are not making any conscious efforts to change the narrative. And so what am I saying? The Madaites need to change this narrative towards a more positive one. See, it is better to build an all-inclusive game plan. Come up with an inclusive game plan so that if everybody feels part of the deal, he will be ready to die, she will be ready to die, and the system will survive. See, go to Benue State. Recently, I was there. I was discussing with my professor, and he told me, oh, the arrangement they have in place, oh, until thy kingdom come, they will continue to do their governorship thing. See, they have already met and agreed. When this zone, they have divided the chiefs into three zones. If this group, and he told me a reason. If we cover your dad, since our division and the Edomans come in, because the Edomans are very, very educated. The population bows to the Shikama. So you see, modern systems are all inclusive so as to be able to wear away, to do away with attempts to penetrate them. You are existing in a very hostile environment, and you think you should not carry a woman along. You think you should not carry this and that, the youth along. You think you should not carry along all the districts. Supposing two councils interpretation, okay, women. But I'm supporting, I've been the MDA, this and that, you will lose your election. And it is very, very dangerous to start such a thing. Because when people get to know your weakness, it is dangerous. So it is better you don't allow people to know. Just like the chiefs now. Okay, Muslim in the Benue State. Let me repeat once more. Politics is the greatest tool. See, after God, the next thing here on earth is politics. You are only downplaying politics and undermining yourself. Through politics, you give people roads, you deny them roads, you give them schools, you give scholarship, you say they should be driven away, you send soldiers to drive them, to kill them, and nothing happens. That was why a lot of scholars, Weber, for instance, recognizing the centrality of politics in the lives of people, he said it is the only force that has monopoly, legitimate monopoly, over the use of force in society. Weber. He's a great thinker in social sciences, great thinker. Then somebody else spoke about that, David Eastin. He said it refers to authoritative allocation. In other words, politics is the authoritative allocator of resources in society. Yes, you are governor. So who comes to question you, why did you not give us scholarship chances to America? Why did you not give us this? Why did you not give us? You are the authoritative allocator. So anybody that is an authoritative allocator, fear that person. So you cannot therefore do away with politics in your life. You can't. It is the costliest mistake to make, to think that you can succeed. I just told you about the Israelites. They took their material successes as basis. And then this person said, I will show you that I am stronger than you. And then he came. He camped them in where they called concentration camps. And they killed about 6 million of them. So it means that in the march to greatness, politics must be at the heart. But you see, we listed out those tricks. How do you get to benefit from politics? We listed them out. It is important. So I am saying that it is important, important as politics is, critical and indispensable as it is in the march to success. It is important that you mobilize your stakeholder, organize. Engage them in discussions so that they get to understand that the steps we are taking as we speak will not lead us to the dreamland. It is very, very important. Not only that, I'm sure we know, as we speak, not as an individual, but as a tribe. Sarkin Lafia, how many appointments did they give him? Sarkin Lafia. Sarkin Kevi, how many did they give him? Sarkin Nasara, how? So it means that how they size you, whether you can cause anything or not. Yes. Sarkin Mada actually went. He didn't get anything. So it means there is a problem. You know it. We are talking about your future. When I lay fever, will somebody come and drive me from what I'm teaching? Maybe I lay fever. But even at this level, even if I lay fever, I know I will not lack where to put my head until I die. But what of you? We are talking about your future. Very, very critical. You must take steps, conscious steps, of mobilizing your human and material resources to ensure that, yes. And this leads me now to the all-important issue of being able to identify the issue of mobilizing the resources that you have here. For me, I'm a religious person, and I know all of us seated here are religious people. All of us. And we know that whenever God chooses to do anything good in the life of an individual, or a community, God always uses what they have. For instance, from the Christian perspective, I am a Christian. God will always say, what do you have? He said this, he said, use it. How can mother people today be sitting? For instance, those in Akwanga, for instance. I understand that your weather is not as harsh as that of other parts of Nasarawa State, and it's not as cold as this. So it means that, commonsensically speaking, you should try to create certain business ventures that will attract people. If you have a resort here now, a resort, a real resort in its true sense, wouldn't you attract customers? If you have a resort, transporters will benefit, Those that will cook will benefit. See, the opportunities are boundless. Are you waiting for opportunity? Do you have anybody in Abuja who will give you a job? You don't. You are supposed to use the resources that go. Lot of fortunes from that river, especially people around Umaisha and other adjoining communities. So what are you using with the rivers that you have? You have a river that goes like this, turns like this, and then another one goes up to Wamba Road. What are you people doing? So you are waiting for manna to fall from heaven. So please and please, my challenge to you is that God has given you, wherever you find people, God has placed resources that you can use to your greatest advantage, provided you are creative enough. Well, but you see, if you have your businesses running, the money that you will make, people will be looking down on you. They don't know the thousands, the millions that you might be making. So my charge to you, that since you want to be relevant in the scheme of things, youth, make sure you step up efforts to wake your members up from their slumber, that wherever you are, God has deposited wealth here. Yeah. You don't need to go anywhere. It is important. Then there is equally the issue of making sure that you bring out your people from the level of political apathy that exists among our people at the moment. High level of political apathy. High level. What do we mean by political apathy? Lack of interest, negligence, like the Jews did. See, if the Jews did their own, it was because they were successful. They said, no, I don't need politics. I'm a successful lawyer. I'm a successful businessman. I'm a successful contractor. That was one. But what of you, the mother people? What informs your lack of interest? Then, when I think, it reminds me of what Robert Dahl, one great political scientist from America, it reminds me of what he said. He said, usually, apathy sets in politically when people think that the benefits they would derive from a system is not commensurate with the efforts they will put in. So they will prefer to go and engage in something else because it will not benefit them. It will not benefit them as other ventures. So it is important. See, any community that is politically apathetic, politically negligent, refuses to take part in politics is doomed, let me tell you. I'm saying it authoritatively. You must take part in politics. The policies that we make, the decisions that we make, the sharing of projects, the this and that, everything, giving of scholarship to people and so on, all of them, they are the political things that we are talking of. Then how can you afford to be shut out from this? How can you afford? It is not possible. So it is important that you mobilize your people. You give them political education. Yes, give them political education. Give them positive political education so that rather than engage in the things that they are doing now, they will shun them. Rather,
they will embrace a culture of openness, inclusiveness, discussion, so that as a result of that, you forge consensus on the best way forward. It is very, very important. It is unfortunate that we do not give pride or place to this one. And then, as we speak, like I was saying earlier on, we do not seem to embrace the culture of planning. See, anybody planners often say that refuses to plan has planned to fail. Anybody that refuses to plan, anybody at all that refuses to plan. If you intend to contest election in the future, what are you supposed to do? All the greeting, all the this, all the, you mean you are doing it for what? Is it not an entry behavior? It is an entry behavior. That is the planning that we are talking about. See, you must, as a politician, look forward. You must prepare yourself. You must gear up. You must look to the future and come up with realizable strategies of how you can arrive at that your destination. If you don't, you will fail. So, youth, teach your members the culture of planning. Look into the future. Let them be futuristic in their plans for politics. Okay, so as we are going now, okay, what we want to do? Let's plan to build an all-inclusive system. As from now, henceforth, in order to, supposing they say, okay, we want to zone the position of deputy speaker to women, isn't it? Now you come and sit down amongst yourself in order to carry women along in our area. All of us have agreed, a woman should come. Are you not building an all-inclusive system? That is what we are saying. We are zoning this. Okay, they will give us this. We mother here, we no longer want commissioner. Give to our brothers in Kokona. Give to our brothers in Kefu. Give to our brothers in Karuloka government. Plan, let it be conscious. Not a thing that you do because you are forced. As we speak, let me tell you, we are ready to break away from you because you have not been inclusive. That's the truth. And we that are there are more than you. You know it. We are more than you, and we are ready. So if you don't build us into your plan, we will strike against you and you will fail. So that I can share all of us that will give up the zone. That is what we want. So you think is that true? See, systems that are durable are not constructed along this line. They are not constructed around inequality, injustice. When you construct systems that have justice and fairness built into them, they are durable, they can last, then you are not doing it. So if the elders are not doing it, if they have not done it, make sure that you build such into your march forward. Please, it is important. This leads us to the challenges ahead. The challenges ahead, I'm sure from the discussions we have had, nobody needs to tell you that number one, we have been playing this politics without vision. See, it will pay you. It will pay you if you understand a lot of these realities taking place. In Kokona, the mother is still regarded as a settler. In Kokona, the mother is still regarded as a settler. So there was a councilorship election that was held. And it may surprise you, but if you know Mada, you should not be surprised. A Mada boy. I understand that boy who contested the election was his relation. What is the difference between Angwantakwa and Gente in Kokona that you know? They are related. They are all Kaja people. Isn't it? We understand that. A boy from one of those two villages was contesting election. And because they had problems before, you know what the other boy did? Fellow mother, Dangwanshi, from Kaja, like him. The result that the brother won election in that polling unit by wide margin. Yeah, they will result in. So the boy lost election. To a Bandara man that calls him a stranger, a settler. Recently, we visited His Excellency Governor A.A. Sule in Abuja. Western Mada in Western Senatorial, we visited him. And he brought up this issue. He said, oh, Mada, the greatest challenge I have, the coup, Shine, you don't even love yourselves.
And then he brought up the issue. The mother woman was found the most suitable, qualified for appointment as permanent secretary in Kokona. The whole of Kokona, none, nobody, no district was as qualified as that woman in terms of performance, qualification, composure, and so on and so forth. So he made up his mind. They bar my daddy appointment. In Azama called, then a madam man who had benefited from government support before, from support of mother before, mother himself went and gave him a petition that Shubos Yada appointed Nataba by Shinsi Oriba. This Magana the Mukai just 3-4 weeks ago, so what are you playing the politics for? I told you earlier on that anybody that participates in politics without a vision is a loser. This is what Maga people are doing. How can you win? In Akwanda here, there are cases that you say, Madaya Tepiache, Bakachiba, this and that, and you lost the election. There are such cases. And then we sit here and say, see, that is why a lot of people who are from my place, who know me here, I have stopped attending these kinds of meeting. Don't have any, it's a waste of my time. We can't sit down and agree this is our interest, and then you go from behind and you backstab us. So how do you think we can succeed if we are playing politics of visionlessness, politics without vision, politics without definite targets to achieve? How are we thinking? You can play our politics. When they want to give you money, you say, all I want, give my children an appointment. Those appointments, you do not know what they will rise to become in future. How did late Daniel Dauda of blessed memory, how did he become? Was he not just a common student he helped? Very fragile student, JS1 student, Agonon College, Kefi, that told his father, who was inspector at NYSC, this and that, billions without are not making. So if you give appointments, so if you are going into politics, go with the aim, say what you have definite things to achieve. That is your vision in politics. Not come as well about that. Every day you see, I understand to my pain that mother people will live here to tell you what you may bring a lunch and then they will rush back. Lunch. How will the governor respect you? How to go and do lunch and then sit down? Then if you come for serious things, Gobe, will he give attention to you? It is unfortunate. So if we want to be empowered, we must overcome this obstacle of lack of vision. We play politics without vision. We play politics without definite goal in mind, what we want to achieve. And then the issue of unity of purpose. We always undo ourselves. I told us earlier on that, see, you are considered nothing in politics as an individual. You are rated high based on your population. Or population. But see, as I stand here, I accept completely what this great military general and philosopher of China said, Sun Tzu. He said, what is very, very critical is not just mere numbers, but the quality of the numbers. See, the truth about politics is this. If you have two people who understand the psychology of the system, they can always unpack what has been packed and make you to benefit. How many blacks are in the US compared to the whites? That Obama won election there because he understood what he needed to tell the people. He understood. For mother people to get what is due them in this system, they must, I'm saying must, you must have unity of purpose. Once one person goes and says, this is what, stand by it. This is not what you do now. This person goes and says, he goes and blackmails this person, that one goes and does. At the end of the day, the governor says to me,
So you must have unity of purpose. See, and that's why I'm talking of having a shared vision. Anywhere that you don't share a vision, share a vision. See, how do you imagine a situation where after walking your wife, after walking your girlfriend, after walking your children into your vision, and they shout, they are, because they know from what you have told them, they know they will benefit greatly. So they embrace it, and they will be ready to die. We don't have this. How can we succeed in politics? And I'm benefiting just one or two people, maybe that's me. People that say, okay, but you know, that informs the issue of the political apathy that we are talking about. So people must benefit. People must believe in your vision. They must share that vision with you that Idan Anchi Mozambique, that will benefit. And then they will be ready for that. It is unfortunate that we are playing this game, this all-important game we are playing, without having a vision, without having unity of purpose. I don't know how we are thinking. It is unfortunate. Not only that, politics of poverty is one issue. So even if you are poor financially, you cannot be poor in terms of ideas. Because poverty is not only restricted to money or material things. It can be poverty of ideas. And I want to assure you that the moment you play your politics around the issue of rich ideas, that will generate money for you. See, when you have rich ideas, you think that there is a need for you to have one vision, to share the vision, to have unity of purpose. And when you collect yourself together, you do registration, good registration. As we speak today, between Kefi and Akwanga local government, which one, which is bigger in population? Sure. But when it comes to electoral value, you don't have electoral value. Why is it? Because, why is it so? Because you are divided. You don't share a vision. See, when there used to be Nasarawa and Toto put together, any man who contested election in Nasarawa local government then always waited for votes from Toto. Isn't it? Always waited for votes. What was the magic? They all agreed. They may pretend to be in different parties, but they have unity of purpose. Please take note. They have unity of purpose. Because if you are not there, you will not know the tricks they are planning against your people. If you are not there, you will not know. So what they do is that they share themselves. They have a unity of purpose. At the end of the day, it is the man that the Ibirapipu, it was the man that Ibirapipu wanted. Dala the Ondachi of blessed memory, will never forget what the Ibirapipu did to him. That is the power of sharing one vision, having a purpose, unity of purpose. See, please and please, if you must march in this game successfully, then you must. Whether you like it or not. It is a must, it is a condition. This is an obstacle amongst you people here. You are not succeeding, largely because you don't have unity of purpose. See, if I, as an individual, will succeed without my people around me, it is better I am not. It is better I am not. But unfortunately, that doesn't seem to be. So, it is important. What I'm saying is, yes, we are poor financially, but we are not poor in terms of ideas. So our people must work around the resource they have. The resource they have, which is ideas, they must harvest their ideas together to ensure that they come up with very robust, strong systems that will enable the authorities that be to give them the things that they deserve. So you can strengthen yourself. I agree, financially, you may not be there, but certainly you are rich in ideas. Use those ideas. You recall when, sorry, you are a Muslim, but I'm only bringing this analogy to make a more graphic picture of what I'm saying. When the disciples complained to Jesus that people were hungry, they should go and eat, Jesus told them something. Do you have anything around? And they said, we have fish, 2, and we have 5 loaves of bread. That's why I told you, see, if any man
Any mother tells me wherever should have been the same, but even like Riyani. Wherever you are, the wealth that now can God has deposited, it remains for you to be creative. So God told them, okay, bring the two whatever of fish, and then and he prayed and it multiplied. You are aware of that. So God is the God of provision. So as we speak today, as we speak, if you are interested in turning around your misfortunes politically, you can do so. You can do so through rich collection, harvest of the ideas that you have. You can come up with very robust arrangements to ensure that the system no longer continues as it is. You can turn around the situation. Unless you are determined. If you are not, you go and begin your petty fight. So any APC, NPDP, may even those that are wise, they are into politics, some of the what they will benefit as a group. They are not into politics to talk. That's a cheap party, eh? And that is what Mutumi Mada tells you. Educated as he or she claims, he talks about party. Party nonsense. Let me ask us, Madana and Esuna are PDP compared to Hausawa. They own both the PDP and the APC. When it comes, wherever it will favor them, they will teach Amawe Kunzona that you and I have not benefited anything from them. Kunzona weapon as he has. Is that politics? Politics that you work against your interests? Angle registration, no voters. You are talking about APC. Are you talking about your interests as a nation? That if you produce 250,000 votes tomorrow, the governor will find you a very beautiful bride to negotiate. Koba Akaba. And then when you are talking your APC and PDP, one and the it will be to the favor of this. And as a result of that, you will produce your usual 20,000 votes. And then you want Aida Ku. No wonder the governors have said it over time that Kokui voting now, Akoba Kui voting Bazenchi. They are telling you about your voting strength. So work on yourselves, please. Work on yourselves. If you want Abaku employment, if you want Abaku aside to boreholes in your villages, Abaku boarding schools, Abaku this, board appointments. Do you have any chairman of board in Nasarawa State? Do you have any secretary of board in Nasarawa State? Is that not a sign of your weakness in the system, that you are not valued? Doesn't that tell you? How do you come about reversing that trend, that negative trend? How? Is it by your petty divisions? Then there is the issue of lack of respect for elders and constituted authority. Oh, it is in this regard that I say, oh, I spit on the intelligence of the government matter. He will usually say, "Weshine ina bani tuona chi." See, for goodness sake, if not in Africa, in the 21st century, why am I in Amagana? See, in fact, if you discuss with those that have globetrotted, those that have traveled across the world, they will tell you, even ba when the man Amagana nama, who is talking about food? And now you tell a madam man, I've been the vacation. And he will tell you, shine in abani to own chi. You see the one feeding me? Who talks about feeding? In the 21st century, we are talking about how you can influence government actions in terms of policies, in terms of programs, in terms of projects, in terms of this and that, in your own favor. These are the things that we are talking about. And then you are talking about food. What is food? It is unfortunate. Oftentimes, the house man sits. Okay, after doing all their calculations, that one and they will advance the cost now. So they will come and say, so, as from today, this is the person that they take. Baya Farua. So let me ask us, mother people, what is wrong with mother? The young boy, when they had to, see, who tells you, who has told you, even in the Bible, who has told you, who has told you? Tell me how many places, apart from the book of Hosea, that the Bible talks about knowledge. There is nowhere, I think, anywhere that the Bible talks about wisdom, wisdom, wisdom. So who tells you that because Katefima Karanta, then your elders, you disrespect them. When they tell you, stop, 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 you don't listen to them. How can you win?
See, let me tell you, I told us earlier on that this life is a war. And when you are fighting war, you need to mobilize all the weapons around you to enable you to succeed. And the greatest weapon is that of wisdom. The greatest weapon is that of wisdom. When your parents tell you, they have a better plan for you, just wait upon them. You don't want to wait. And at the end of the day, see, if you prevent me from winning today, tomorrow I will prevent you. The day after tomorrow, we will prevent ourselves, and it continues like that, and we'll continue to grow weaker, as we are doing today. So it is therefore better that I become the fool. You get me? For the sake of the tribe, I should be able to say, though when I contested, he worked against me, I will support him. Kaganiza Kuchi, it begins a new chapter in your history. And that is not the case in this tribe. It is not. You talk to them, they will refuse. And you do not know that when you exist, when you play politics with folks, with wolves, with lions, with very hostile people around, they will usually want to stretch your creativity, your wisdom. They will want to test to see whether you are wise or not. And just a little trial reveals to them that you are not wise. When they tell you to contest against your brother, say, Keka Yonga, the awesome man will usually say, to give you the height of their deceit, 10 of them will agree, Che Waza Sutaya, back home. They will agree that just between there. Kagani, in the first place, they have deceived you to hang on, two or three of you, but their candidate is one and they will win. Your elders talk to you and you say, no problem. Thank God you are a beneficiary of what you are doing to yourself. The elders are benefiting from their undoing, and the youths are also benefiting because they are the ones that are used to embark on all these dirty things. You undo yourselves. It is very, very sad that you engage in such. You must respect constituted authority. Let me tell you this. Though democracy appears to be the most fashionable democratic product in the world now, I tell you, there are countries that have moderated their version of democracy, and it is working. They are using authoritarianism. Tell any South Asian at all about democracy, he will look at you and laugh. They have moderated it. They use authoritarianism. That is the views of their leaders. They stand. And who gave them this idea? It was their great leader of China, many thousands of years ago, Confucius, who gave them that you must respect elders, you must respect your ancestors, so that is what they stand by. See, without respect for constituted authorities, without respect to your elders, I tell you, you will go nowhere. No wonder it is said that what an elder lies down, see, even if you climb the top of a mountain, you will never see. And that remains a very, very great undoing of the mother nation. As we speak today, it is unfortunate. You don't listen. Is it possible for everybody to be a leader? It is not possible. Some people must be subsumed under others. It is that today that explains largely the miraculous breakthroughs in Southeast Asia, Hong Kong, China, Singapore, this and that, authoritarianism. That is, the leaders will sit down and say, this is what we have decided, and it is binding on all. Why can't you do that? It is unfortunate. I have not seen a situation where people succeeded because they were all leaders. No, one person must lead, few people must lead. It is unfortunate that we think we want to succeed. And then lack of courage, absence of vibrant network, all are issues we dealt with before. Yes. Then there is the issue of absence of lack of persuasion, lack of ability to understudy an area and come up with appropriate strategies for remedying them. From all I have said, it is very, very obvious
that things have fallen apart and the center is not holding in matter. If in the 21st century, you don't have 10 professors, if in the 21st century, you don't have 3 consultants, I tell you, Abun Kunyani, the person that was typing this for me, I was ashamed. I took it to another person because they didn't see me. In the 21st century, you know what one, see, look at him seated here. He knows what the present CMD has done to their people. He knows Dashina. He knows what the former DVC, Nasarawa State University, Yakubu Haruna, he knows what he did to them. How many people did he employ? You are sitting here and talking of Baabako employment, Baabako this. How? If you have not done the basics, there are basics. If you have not done them, you don't expect success. You don't. You can never have success. See, there are preconditions. Just like water cannot boil until this and that happen, you cannot succeed in politics unless you meet this conditions. You cannot. We cannot expect under this situation, no division, no lack of vision, now working at cross purposes with one another, doing this, doing that, we cannot expect to succeed. It is unfortunate. And so for us to be able to overcome this, I suggest a number of things that we do. One, which is what the leadership of your council, youth council, is doing. You must mount aggressive, regular campaigns among the youths and others to engage them in discussions, sharing, cross-fertilization of ideas, so as to understand the way forward. They will bring out their views. What is the problem of the women? Why are they not progressing as the few men in Mada, this and that? At the end of the day, you will come out with very, very good ways forward. So you must step up the level of mobilization, sensitization. You continue to engage people. You can organize it according to districts. You can organize it according to class. Whatever you choose to do, make sure that you step up this, because as we speak, the situation is very, very pathetic. Yeah, our visibility is disappearing. When we say visibility, it means that, yes, SSG, since they created Nasarawa State, has Mada become secretary to the state government? And you think that doesn't speak a language? Doesn't it tell you that it speaks that you are nothing? It doesn't tell you. It should tell you. See, this is important because in the political era, you use your votes to correct those injustices done. But when you are divided, how can you? You are divided. You don't share a vision. So it is important. Please step up this level of awareness creation amongst the youths, wherever. In addition to this, please and please, tell all the others who have not had the privilege of coming that, see, for me as a person, I always see challenges. If you read Aldous Huxley, he titles the book Brave New World. If you read Aldous Huxley's book Brave New World, he tells you something. The greatest fuel for success in the world is difficulties, challenges, obstacles. I am hoping that from this gathering, we are generating the desire, we are generating the steam to go back tomorrow and say this narrative must change. Let me read what Wilmot says in responding to this kind of situation. Wilmot admonishes that recognition of ignorance is the beginning of knowledge, while recognition of weakness may be the beginning of strength, provided one has the knowledge and determination and will to transform ignorance into knowledge, weakness into strength, and defeat into victory. So the mere fact that we are at the base of the ladder today, I tell you, it should make us more successful than others. Why am I saying so? See, I always believe, if anybody comes and tells me that he doesn't have a father, he doesn't have a mother, that's why, I always look and laugh. That one is for stupid minds. See, Anything that God allows to happen to you, God is using that to stimulate the greatness in you so that it will come out. So it is expected that with the disadvantages we suffer today in critical areas of life in the state, since we suffer those disadvantages, it is expected that this will be a wake-up call to all of us, that everybody will return to his or her drawing board and see what we can do to change the narrative, to change, to reconfigure happenings among the mother people. It is expected that we go back and do the needful to change. And we can only do that provided, rather than accept, submit, surrender, we are able to take up the challenge and turn the present defeat we suffer to give us victory. I just charge us that it is very, very important that we do this. It's very, very important. Then we are talking of the issue of bringing in place aggressive human resource development arrangements in place. For me, in this age, it is not, I was just telling the other person we came with, and I told him, hey, when I see people show wealth in terms of the number of vehicles they have, this and that, I laugh. The present age that we are in is about knowledge wealth, wealth from knowledge. Which, if you have skillful people today, they can make millions, they can make billions in few seconds. They can make their contacts, make all their connections and do. And that is why you go to a surgeon, you go to a specialist in medicine. What you think that is just so simple, person sits down, puts his or her creativity to work, and before long, the person has made millions. I'm sure you know, some consultants, some doctors, they charge, depending on the nature of the issue, they charge in millions. That is it. So nobody is talking. See, you must be able to have vibrant, functional, regular training and retraining of your human resources. You must. There is no way. I believe that more wealth comes from having developed people mentally than all this one that you are talking of. Yes. And I was saying further that supposing you have the leading robotic engineer, this engineer that is about present day trendy artificial intelligence engineering, that you can create robots to do what human beings can do. If you do, it means that you'll be sitting with Bill Gates, because they will want you, they want to use you to generate wealth, isn't it? You'll be sitting with Elon Musk, you'll be sitting with Jeff Bezos, the richest people on earth, isn't it? You'll be sitting with them. And I want to assure you with every level of certainty that Jeff Bezos, Elon Musk, the Italian, Bill Gates cannot call Buhari and ask for a favor today, and they will not do. So who tells you that you can develop without developed human capacity? Please, youths, make sure that you bring up play. See, I am disappointed that despite all the so-called progress we think we have made in MADA, I have not seen people float scholarship schemes to sponsor people to read trendy courses. I'm disappointed. See, one person that you help to train, only God knows the miracle that that person can do. That small boy in government college that helped let Daniel Dauda to go to NYSE. You see the miracle that Daniel Dauda did. So that step that you take tomorrow in sponsoring these young ones to go to school. See, the mere fact that I'm here is just a privilege. There are better persons, more intelligent persons, wiser persons than myself, because they didn't have the opportunity of going to school. That is why I feel that I'm better than them. Why not create such enabling platform for your human resources? I believe that human being, that society develops more with developed human beings than money or whatever. I don't believe in that. So I charge you.
And even over any other things, many other things you can forget them. Just hang on to education. Those trendy areas. And see whether in a few years you will not cover. One deal. How much does a good lawyer, Sam, how much does he make in one election petition? Have you ever heard the amount of money they make before? They make hundreds of millions. So that day when they know money, you arrive at that. Otherwise, you are not relevant to your constituency, which are the ones. You are not. See. Doctor, Mrs. This, Doctor, Mrs. That. Recently, I was here. Go to all the universities in Nigeria. Wallahi, you must meet these people there. He's either a senior lecturer, a professor, or this and that. And I was asking professor, he said long ago, they took conscious steps. They sat and agreed that this is what we must do. So who tells you today that if, for instance, you are the best doctor at brain surgery, who tells you that your people will not make money? Because of that, they may even give you CMB of a teaching hospital. And from there, all the employment, all the contracts, all the this you give your people. So you see what education can do. So who tells, don't take Magana human resource development, don't take it lightly. Anybody that wants to cheat you will underdevelop you that wise. So make sure you force your politicians, but Magana sooner so many. This leads me to the issue of accountability. A youth tried approaching me on this issue. That how can we tackle the issue of abandoning people? When you have used them, you dump them and go. How can we tackle? Very simple, very simple. You see? You see, not because of your divisions. Petty, along petty lines. She answers, Umreinaku. What is the beauty of democracy? Especially that you are knowledgeable, you are educated. What is the beauty? Siba. If I have made up my mind about something, no amount of persuasion, no amount, they change in course now. See, those your politicians today, you can hold them to account. See, bring up mechanisms, accountability checks. Tell us, how many people who sat at the House of Assembly? How many people did you employ? In Kefi where I live, there are people. One of them, Dangote, he was in the House of Assembly maybe about 8-10 years ago. He bought close to 100 appointments for Yara. You people here will not do it because of pettiness that the clan Namune, the Menene, Menene is my uncle. If your uncle is not doing the needful, you are supporting me. They must give you a report card of what they have done for you. That is what, in advanced climes, that is what they do. Tell us. Why do you think we should choose you? Why do you think we should support you? You don't do that. For what? How can you benefit from politics? So a way forward is to develop accountability mechanism. Develop it. In terms of infrastructure, our constituency, Naka. In terms of this, tell them. Tell me how Gobe, when they go there, they will abandon you. How would they abandon you? It pains me when people are there. See, I was telling somebody, I said, you can't be in the House of Assembly and then you don't go to Federal Medical Center to play politics there. What politics will you play? Take 200, 300,000, go and do something for them in Federal Medical Center. How I wish the politicians were here. Go and do something for them in a Federal Medical Center. How many of them went to do something, endow something in Federal Medical Center? How will they give them? They will not give them. Go to Nasarawa State University. Go to Nasarawa State Polytechnic. Go to this, go to that. spend 1 million naira and do something here in Anzo Abubobe, that's what we make. And who are the ones to force them to do that? Who is that queen? And you don't want to do. And you are expecting, what are you expecting from them? See, we in political science always believe in one thing, that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts, absolutely. So it is because Koda Kainema Ambaka, Bache, Bakoni, Anna weaving around, Anna Maganan sentiment, Clan Namune, this is our time. That is what you are suffering. Then who are you blaming? Your time? When your contemporary Sunagama, Anna Baswaiki, and then you are waiting and talking about your clan. Clan nonsense. Eh? Bring up mechanisms for holding your representatives to account. Engage them in discussions. Are you afraid of them? Kekas are based on you are afraid of them. See, if the youth mean business, wallahi, no politician. They want to say they are going. Not the other going to do a back. Tell us. Dangote that went and spent how many millions in Abuja? That you are in the House of Assembly and you cannot buy jobs for your people. See, in the Nigeria of today, who talks about way Dakatavi you get employment on merit? Who talks about that? Only exceptionally few people get appointments on the basis of their merits. Most of the appointments, minister, this and that, PAMSEC, senator, House of Reps. Bakudeshi, so tell me how you can do. Even when you had there, what were they able to do? Did you hold them to account? You tell them, and you are afraid. Eh? See, one of the obstacles also the Kuna facing, which is a way forward that I want to see. You must come out of your timidity. Timidity, you must come out of it. Magana kunya, magana does not even arise. This is about your future and the future of generations yet unborn. You cannot afford to come here and just play games with it and you leave. You cannot. You must demand for their report sheet. It is on the basis of this that we can move forward. So, as we speak, by way of conclusion, as we speak, you and I have even, you seated there, even have better ideas about the state of affairs of the mother nation, more than I do, a lot of you have. So, what can you do in order to change the situation? The ball is in your court. We are in a democracy. 2023 is drawing close. You better bring up arrangements, mechanisms in place. As discussed earlier, you better bring up mechanisms in place to ensure that you build all-inclusive systems. Systems that will carry all interest groups along. Because once they are committed, they will want to die for the project you are standing for. Make sure you bring this in place. Take clan aside. Take district as, take anything, bring up mechanisms that can hold your leaders to account. Hold them to account. On the basis of this, you see, I'm saying that because the fact is this, whether you like it or not, whether I like it or not, the fact remains that as we speak, we have wolves around, we have lions around. We have wolves around, we have lions around. See, you must therefore ensure that you come up with appropriate and timely responses to the situation of lack of job, poverty, and so on and so forth. And the only way you can do that is the use of the votes that you have, the opportunity that you have, in order to hold to account all those that represent you at whatever level. It is only on the basis of that that you can derive benefits. As we speak, tell me, I was asking you earlier on that, show me any mother that has two trailers. I want to see somebody now. In Toto, where our brother comes from, they have even aeroplanes, not trailer, because they have been able to master their politics. That is what I'm saying.
they have been able to master. They are in charge, are on top of their politics. So if you want to be on top of your politics and get things righted and get things done correctly, the ideas, the skills that you have, make sure you harness them together. You harvest them in such a way that they make you to be a strong voice. Just speak with one voice. The moment you do that, when they go to this district, the youth are speaking the same language. They go to that one, they are speaking. They say, no, go and meet our leaders. Ungamadisu, what you want will come. Thank you very much.
Is that all? Please, you can do better than that. In standing ovation, please, let's put a hand together for a well done paper presentation. Once again, well done, sir. And it will please you to know that he is a senior lecturer with the Department of Political Sciences, Nasarawa State University, KEFI. Please, sir, I don't know, are we to entertain any question now or we should forge ahead? Is there any? Okay. Okay, we have two. Okay, but before then, he said that I should permit him to introduce songs that he came along with, which I believe that will have been done before now, and it's still the right time to do it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Along with me are some very, very vibrant youths who are very, very interested in the activities. They have made tremendous and immeasurable contributions. One of who is Mr. Joshua Bako, he's a private person. He's a geologist by training into private practice. Joshua Bako, you're welcome. Yes. Then, this one, do I call him my elder or what? Seated behind Joshua Bako is my one-time student and about to be a barrister. Yes. Mr. Benjamin Malo, you are welcome. So, you see, I was accusing you people of underdeveloping, underrepresenting us. We came all along with them from yonder, and I thought that you would have taken your time to know. Which way to organize all sections along. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. My name is Philip N. Barnum. The Madam President, the Speaker, the DPO of Okwanga Local Government, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Sir, you have made justice to this presentation, and I'm happy to be part of it. When you suffer from a great injustice, you see little one as a favor. And I want to believe this is exactly what is happening in our society. And the politicians know about it and they are taking advantage of it. Now, my question is, the structure in our society make the youth to behave irresponsible, if I can use that word, that you see a graduate that cannot stand and defend himself or to checkmate people in power. And I make bold to say this. I work with the federal government. When you criticize the politician, thinking you are helping the graduate, I mean the unemployed graduate, these same people who've been attacking you. I'm not criticizing because I need any favor from a politician, but because when I come back and see my youth, my brothers, my sister, unemployed, it disturbs me. When you try to criticize, the same people will insult you and call you all manner of names. Sir, what can we do in regards to this? Thank you very much.
Well, for me, this interaction is a reciprocal one, in the sense that we are expected to generate answers and respond to the questions that are asked. And so persons who are seated here may give appropriate answers to what he has said. It is not out of place. It is important, since the purpose of being here is that of ensuring how we can forge the way forward for this tribe that is almost sinking. The truth is that it is almost sinking, whether you like it or not. It is almost sinking. If you will be giving a commissioner and the commissioner is not in a sensitive area, does that tell you that you are valued? So you see, the truths are there, the indices are there. You don't have this, you don't have that, and so on and so forth. They are there. So it is good. So, by way of direct response to you, the journey of 2 million years begins with conception, not even a step. Maybe the step may be conception. Think of it in your mind. When you think of it, you begin to think of appropriate ways of mobilizing. This mobilization that we are talking of is not something that will materialize in one day. It's not something that will materialize in 2 days. Isn't it? Continue to engage your constituents, who are mostly the youth, who suffer this predicament of lack of job. Why are they suffering from lack of job? Because they have not held their representatives to account. That's the truth about it. That's the truth about it. The moment you engage very actively, very creatively, members of your constituency, you meet traditional rulers, you meet this, you meet that. I tell you, by the time you get to many of them, they may come out confessing to you that indeed that is what has been staring them in the face. I want to believe you people met Chomada about the employment in Nasarawa State University. Did he tell you how? He was disappointed. Why some traditional rulers were giving 20, giving 15, giving this that I know that we all know. One was not given to him. So if you discuss with him, seek, you can only get the attention of somebody to the extent of that person committing himself or herself. When you scratch the place that is itching the person, tell the person what that person has been suffering and see whether that person will not respond positively. So what I'm saying is you can initiate the process of engaging members of the constituents. You are working. Guerrilla tactics, why is it in place? If you cannot face the enemy because he's stronger than you, you distract him here, you distract him, and at the end, gradually you penetrate. So this is the kind of one strategy that you can adopt in order to ensure you can use some other youths. You get me? See, the moment you have accountability mechanisms in place, when you check them, okay, you want to go to a house of, okay, you were a counselor before. Can we have a rundown of what you did? Can we have a rundown? Are you the one that, see, come out with templates that you can hold them to account? By the time you are doing it gradually, your constituents will come to appreciate what you are doing, and they will come to own. Because it is one thing to start something. It is another to make people buy into it, to share the vision. Very, very critical. Once you are able to bring up
bring up ways that they seem beneficial to them, they will buy into what you are saying. So I know with time, this may be the situation at the moment, but certainly with time, they will certainly come on the same page as you, just like you are saying. Yes, any other responses to, in order to meet this challenge that he has brought? That more often than not, some youths, because of the situation on ground, will not want to face the politicians and tell them the truth. They will like to divert. If you want to speak on their behalf, they will rally round. Let me tell you, time it was in South Africa during the liberation struggle, when they discovered that from amongst them, there were traitors, those that were betraying the cause, they sat and all agreed. As from today, if we do something and we find out that this, that also are our traitors, we will deal with them. I tell you, that moment, the momentum of the liberation struggle changed. You can put a lot of mechanisms in place to check this kind of thing. If you people are so committed, you are so determined. But it requires a lot of conscientization, reconscientization regularly. You talk, you engage them in discussions across. You discover that gradually, some of those beliefs will begin to give way to the new order that you are talking to. They will give way. I assure you. Yes. See, the condition that Mada people are in today, see, I have a book titled Rural Development, Learning from China by Sartaj Aziz. If you go through the book and you have the gift of crying, you will cry because of the situation that China was in. When did China start this all-important breakthrough, this revolution? Just about 70 years ago. It was in 1949. And today, China is most feared, is most dreaded, is most... Why? Because they took appropriate steps. See, when they started that revolution, there were divisions. There were the Mensheviks here and the Bolsheviks. They embarked on a number of things, but they sacrificed. So the result of that sacrifice today is what you have as great China today. So I want to tell you that any such thing that you are starting, don't think that it is easy. That was why we tried to bring up some likely challenges that you face on the way of this project. We brought them up so as to alert you that, mind you, you will face such challenges. So you should be ready. And you can overcome this by stepping up the level of awareness amongst your constituents. Get your critical stakeholders involved. Let them see reason. If I become a senator, isn't it? I should use that as a platform to become deputy senate president, eventually senate president, to become governor, because that is the trend, and eventually this and that in Nigeria. So ask them, our politicians, are you under spell that you became senator and you are going regressing, going backward? It means something is wrong. I tell you, by the time you engage them in very useful interactions, I tell you, you generate their enthusiasm. You excite them so much that they will cooperate with you to bring about the desired change. Allay their fears. This change is not for the youth alone. It's not about harming anybody, but it's just about our future and the future of our children. That is the essence of this struggle. It's not for the sake of undermining anybody. But if you don't do, I tell you, it will be terrible. Yes. When somebody has sized you and understands that you are very weak, next time will he care about you? Even if he will not care, that is what is happening to this tribe. Gradually, the tribe is dying. Gradually. I know from the way you are doing tomorrow, Nganzo, Magana, registration, voters, you go and bring, Akwanga local government has 2,000 registered voters. Don't worry. See whether that's a collado. Please. Anche Kukang Kurchia Jawabi Nego. These are signs to you that people are about taking over your place. If you like, ponder over it. If you don't like, Kako Damuga.
our speaker of today, the youth president, all other protocol duly observed. My name is Blenta Dongon. I came in, I was practically quoting a lot of things you said, error-proof and all-inclusive system, taking a conscious step, political apathy, shared vision, and today you succeeded in changing my mentality about this particular phrase. When a madam said, last you were Nengaki, Ryu, you know, but today you succeeded in changing it. This particular phrase is becoming obsolete because it's no longer about food. We've gone deep, you've changed it. Now, I was in a gathering day before yesterday. A madam wrote a paper for presentation. You know, he was challenging the Egon Nation. He said they had lot of professors and doctors, but unfortunately, they don't seem to be impacting in their immediate environment, and I agree. This afternoon here, you talked about it again. How many professors do we have? How many doctors do we have? How many consultants? And I was shaking my head, and I discovered that better them that even have, even though they are not impactful, but what about us? And I'm so happy that I'm part of this interaction and discourse. But the question I want to ask, I don't know whether as a doctor of philosophy in political science, whether you've made any move to gather other students, to gather students from this extraction, to gather people and talk to them like this. I believe as a person, I've been enlightened and I know that I am moving. But I'm feeling for other people that are not here. With this potential in you, whether by force or by fire, push this thing inside us so that tomorrow this revolution will kickstart with us. Thank you very much.
So, what will I tell you now? I told you at the onset of my presentation that the moment I stepped in here, my morale was dampened. Even as we speak, I expected thousands of people around, not a few hundreds. But I said, well, I told you, I said, well, the journey of whatever mileage begins with a step. That is my belief. And so that is the awareness arousing that we are engaging in. It is very, very discouraging that, see, as we speak today, as we speak, there are lots and lots of scenarios I have cast in this paper that will tell you, compare your tribe with this one and you discover that we are nowhere. See, when relatively smaller tribes are catching juicy employment, are catching this and that, what does that tell you? You should have the cause to sit back and question yourself. Something is fundamentally wrong. You have the cause. And what am I saying? I am saying that as far as I'm concerned, I tell you, the root cause of the problem is within the Muslim people. Because if you build an all-inclusive system, like I said earlier on, when they want to go to Mutani Bada West to woo them to support the Namutunde Badawa Suido, because we are one. When they come to women will say,
vision. We do not know why we are in politics. We place priority on less important things in politics than important ones. That is where we are, where we are. Then I want to assure you that at various levels, I have tried as much as possible. I know at a time, I did kickstart an arrangement where I will be supporting with little amounts of money students from my tribe that in my department who find it difficult to write their project. I did that. I don't need to tell you that there are lots of little things I have done to ensure that I can encourage them. Yes, there are things that we can do. There are things that individuals can do. There are things that they cannot do. They can only do so in collaboration with others. So make sure that this message we are hearing today, make sure that you share this message with as many as possible. See, it is expected that on the basis of what we have spoken here, you will go back, ponder over them, and develop them further. Reject some of the ideas we have brought. Bring in your own that are superior so that we forge ahead as a tribe.
Thank you.
Our paper presenter, Dr. Jaco, seriously, I think you have enriched us a lot today with your presentation. My question, it's a very simple one. It's something that has been bothering me because over time, I thought we're working towards the unity of matter. But recently, I discovered that we are expanding that gap gradually. Because something happened even during my last election. In my first election, my first tenure, it didn't happen. But in this last election we had, I saw it play out. And it really disturbed me. And I made sure that those of us they say that come from like a year back, Mother Sal went to the governor with requests for provost and the rest of that. And another section of Mother within Akwanga went with the same kind of request. So how are we helping ourselves? Rather, we're expanding the division and making the tribe less important and irrelevant in the scheme of things in the state. Because our number, our political strength, is what will give us value in the scheme of things. But right now, I see that great expansion, that great division. So how do we begin to work on this? Because it's something that the youths alone cannot just do that. Because some of these divisions are beginning with the elders and extending down to the youth. Thank you.
When I spoke about all-inclusive march, I knew what I meant. You see, it is important. If we agree that the whole of this life is a struggle, it's a war. War with forces from within and without. If we agree, then we must take very conscious steps in all the things that we do. Like I told you, Oga is here. He knows about the Afro people. Kai, I worked in Nasarawa local government. No matter how you gang up, you cannot get Afro votes torn apart for anybody. Why? Because they have an all-inclusive arrangement in place. They have it. If you do now, they will begin to make analogies. It means that during the next one, we will revenge. Another person will revenge. It means for a long time to come, if not forever, we will not get. But if you are patient now, tomorrow it will be your turn. The day after tomorrow, it will be the turn of that person. Are you not carrying people? Tell me how anybody can easily penetrate. Tell me. So this is critical in the present match that we are in. The thief, I told you also, go to them and you will discover that they have vowed. How do they do it? Any position of governorship in Benue State, they don't think that any tribe at all has legitimacy over the except the team man. And they have arrangements in place. From this zone, it will go to that one. They are not even talking about any other zone. Ask them, they will tell you. And that is it. So once inclusiveness becomes the norm in any arrangement, especially in arrangements that have hostile external environments, it is very, very important that you take note of that. In fact, outsiders who want to penetrate you may want to use such divisions within in order to widen the gap between and amongst you. And it behoves on you as the operators of the system within to ensure that you are able to withstand them.
No matter what you come to tell the youth, when you want to give jobs, you are in the House of Assembly, you go and buy 10 or 20 jobs. Buy with your money. That is what happens in Kebbi. Buy with your money. When you buy, you come, call the leaders. This district, I give them this. That district, I give them. Tell me how tomorrow, in Kaches, we have the this is how people build inclusiveness in their march to their politics. But that is not what happens. Then the other important aspect of this, your question, is how can we have that in place? We can have that in place. I told us earlier on, it is important that we engage all the critical stakeholders in lots and lots of interactions. Are you telling me that if you go submissively, if you talk in a tone that somewhat persuades, that somewhat pleases the paramount ruler of Mada today, if you go and talk to him, he will not open up to tell you how he felt that he went to be given an appointment like other traditional rulers and he was turned down? You mean he will not open? He will open to you. If you go to senators, they have been given. Why are we not? You discuss, you generate. If you generate ideas on the way forward, on the basis of which you now fashion, I will forge a direction. And I want to believe, with time, you may not have 100% commitment to the general cause, but I want to assure you, an overwhelming majority will support the cause of inclusiveness for everybody. It is important. That is what systems see. That is why in other climes, in other countries of the world, you get me? The winner takes all in election does not arise. They make sure that for us not to tear the system apart, your reflection in government will depend on your performance in the election. Why is that? To build inclusiveness. It is important. But you cannot do that alone in isolation, especially if they feel Kanamusu Reshen Hankali, find ways of persuading them. I did mention this earlier on, that we lack respect for constituted authority, for elders. We lack respect for them as a tribe. You talk to your elders anyhow. Yara suna so, say abinde su suna so su yine, iya yesuji. See, no matter how educated you are, it doesn't translate to wisdom. And let me tell us, whether you like it or not, I'm still repeating it. Until the world comes to an end, wisdom will always be ahead of every other thing. So please and please, I know you can generate lines of wisdom from stakeholders around, and you know how to engage critical stakeholders, women, youths, from all the districts, from all the diasporans, the this, the that, the traditional rulers, the politicians. Get to them, generate their views, and see how you will not have a bubbling arrangement in place that carries everybody. That was an agenda that carries everybody.
Thank you. So at this juncture, I'll permit you to go on first. Thank you, sir. Motapa Misha Hanumana. And again, sir, a request. Almost three youths met me and requested for the copy. So I don't know how it's going to be made available. So that it should be not us listening alone, but we should also read. Yes, sir. Okay, the big young man. Thank you, sir. As he is in the paper presentation, we have some dignitaries that came in, which I would love to recognize them. First on the list, we have our uncle, our brother in the house. I'm talking about Sylvia Jasper Fanny. Please, let's put our hands together for him. So you are highly welcome. Also in the house, we have Dr. Emmanuel Bashayi. He is a business consultant. Once again, let's put our hands together for him. Still, same trend, we have Mrs. Salome Mbachan John in the house. Please, you are highly welcome. Let's still put our hands together for her. Also, Mr. John K. Umaru, please, let's still celebrate them. And last but not the least, I have in the house a conscious security officer. I'm talking about the DPO of Akwanga Local Government, Superintendent of Police, Yari Masa, you are highly welcome. Also, my sister in the same chain of struggle, Ankara,
again, Miss Patience Jacob, all the way from our National Broadcasting Service, National State Mutaba Muta Hanumana, and you are highly welcome. The next thing now, I'm going to call the president to come for a function. So you are highly welcome. Please, let's put our hands together for him.
Permit me to stand on all existing protocol. I want us to celebrate our own, the DPO of Akwanga. I think this is the first time in the history of Akwanga local government that we're having a madam man as DPO. Yeah. And you're welcome, sir, and he has come with so much passion to serve the land, for him to even be in our midst, and we're with him in his office, and we know what he's doing in the area of security, because so much has gone wrong in Akwanga local government. We're happy he's doing his best to make sure we're all safe in Akwanga. I also want to appreciate Surveyor Jasper Tani for taking our time, aside the public publicity we did. We didn't do individual publicity, we didn't do individual invitation, and he saw it and he's here. And let's also celebrate him, just like this paper presenter said, we need to expand the scope. Seriously, Mada needs professionals. He's a surveyor, I'm also a surveyor. He's the first surveyor in Madaland. And I happen to follow after him. I think I'm the second. So I don't know, am I right? I think I'm the second. So you can see that we're lacking professionals in so many fields. Like you go to medicals, you go to engineering and the rest of them. So we need to encourage our brothers. And that's one of the things we're trying to do within this dispensation to make sure we create awareness. We want to do vocation, what do you call it? Sorry. Want to guide those that went into SS1 from GS3 on the right course to study, or whether to go into sciences or what. And then those in SS2 that are about to write JAMA also want to guide them so that they will read the right courses so that we can have a future. Or we can have future leaders that are vast. I ran into a group just yesterday and I was so impressed. You can see them in their colorful attire. I saw them at JK Palms and I thought it was just a social gathering. I didn't know it was a group of mother ladies from all over, right? You're from Jos, Kaduna, Lagos, so many places they gathered under the umbrella Mother Youth Lady, Forum for Mother Ladies, yes. And I asked them of their objective, and it was so amazing. It's in line with what you said, sir, because we've been having a lot of issues getting our girls to be involved in a lot of activities that will help build Mother Nation, most especially politics and so many other things. And so we're happy that our sister made us proud to be an SUG president as a lady. It's, I think it was an achievement. So at this juncture, I'd like to introduce them. Then I'll introduce the president or the chairperson. She'll come out and tell us their mission statement so that we will know how to also support them. So I welcome Mrs. Hawa Ibrahim. And some of them are married outside Madaland, but they still have a passion for the land. It's quite amazing and inspiring. Thank you.
Warmly greetings to our guest speaker, the President Mada Development, and all the dignitaries present here. Our mission, the Mada Forum for Mada's Ladies, was founded on the 16th of June, 2020. We started on Facebook. We then went back to WhatsApp. So we have we came from different states, some in Lagos, Jos, Nasarawa here, Niger, Port Harcourt, some are in Dubai. So we usually communicated on the forum. So our mission, Our vision is to, our vision equipping mothers, ladies into bold, enlightened, decent, responsible, and independent ladies to meet up with the positive happening in the in diaspora with which are fully informed in all ramifications. Mission, to attain unity amongst mothers, ladies, both homes and abroad, end and objectives, to expose our ladies in the areas of mental enlightenment, financial independence, and to educate education-wise, also to stand against gender discrimination in the society as a whole. Scope, empowerment, skills acquisition, fight against molestation, creating awareness, publicities, media, rally, both rural and urban areas, radio stations, flyers, banners, handbills, helping hands to less privileged. Conclusion, in nutshell, we Forum for Mother Ladies are appealing for the support of the state government to Mother Nation Youth President, traditional rulers, non-governmental organization, both financially, physically, and morally. Long live Federal Republic of Nigeria. Long live Nasarawa State. Long live Mother Nation.
So we're happy that our ladies are joining the struggle. So we're going to put we're going to harness all these groups together for the progress and development of Mother Nation. At this juncture, we're going to go into the next segment, which is going to be the discussion segment. We're going to have four discussants. Dr. Emma Bashayi is one. He's going to answer questions on entrepreneurship. Myself will talk on youth participation in politics. Mrs. Salome is going to talk about women participation in politics and governance. And then the DP of Akwanga local government is going to talk of youth involvement in security. So we also have the anchor of the program, who is a journalist from MBS. We have Ms. Patience Jacob. So at this juncture, we'll mount the podium and begin the second segment. Thank you.
Yes. I don't hide like this. I never prayed for this. I never knew it could end like this. Well, if you're done with me, oh baby, be good, just set me free. Cause I don't do grace like this. For your love, I didn't lose my senses. Fight boy like me. Don't call me cheap, girl, I work for this. Girl, I work for this. And I promise you, I will find someone, make you no call me water. Make you no call me, don't fuck and stand sweat. If I feel bad, when I call you, no people. When I text you, go read and delete. I know be good, don't know. I know you sabi everything you dey think. You dey call me your boyfriend. Oh, I see they pay for the sex every night. You don't need to say too much. I already know you don't love me much.
All right.
Good afternoon all, and you're welcome to the studio of Mada Youth Summit 2021. I am your anchor, as they have earlier stated, Patience Jacob Chumwe. At this time, I would like to call on our discussant. The guest speaker has done justice to our topic, Mada Youth Participation in Politics, Governance, and Nation Building. And we have our discussants as follows. Because I'm a lady, I will beg you people to permit me to be a little bit gender. It's not selfish. Just to give honor to whom honor is due, I'd like to call on Comrade Mrs. Salome Mbicha John, the former and first ever female SUG president, Nasarawa State University. Kefi, if you are not jealous, can you please clap for her, even as she comes up? Mrs. Salome, it might interest you to note that she is wearing different caps, among whom is the former Vice President Nance, former Vice President on Utility, National Association of Nigerian Students, and also a former Vice President Youth Parliament representing Nasarawa North. This among many other caps she's wearing. Ms. Salome, you are highly welcome to the studio of Mada Youth Summit 2021. Mrs. Salome is already seated, and we also have Dr. Emmanuel Bashai. Dr. Emmanuel Bashai is an entrepreneur and a business consultant. We'd like you to come on stage, Dr. Emmanuel Bashai. Okay, he just stepped out. While we await his arrival, I would like to call on my senior brother, the Divisional Police Officer of Akwanga Local Government Area, CP Yerima. May you please come up as we discuss on what is bothering the youth of Mada, the youth of Akwanga, the youth of Nasarawa State, and the youth of Nigeria. Maybe as we await the arrival of Dr. Emmanuel Bashai and the National President of Mada Development Association, Comrade John Kuni Umaru, I think we can set the boat rolling, but I'll beg you to start clapping for our comrade, Comrade John Kuni Umaru. Can you please come to the studio? We are waiting for you. All right, I think we can start the program since the National President of Mada Development Association Youth Wing is already here, and Dr. Emmanuel Bashai, the business tycoon, the business consultant, is also coming up. Glad to have you all seated here. We have had a word our presenter, the paper presenter, talked about the theme for our 2021 summit, which borders of Mada Youth Participation in Politics, Governance, and Nation Building, even though he restructured the topic to Economic Empowerment. So for this reason, we are going to set the ball rolling. Comrade Kuni, you are our host. You are the one that gathered us here, and we would like to start with you on the theme for this topic, for this year's summit. What is your take on the participation of Mada Youth in politics, governance, and economic empowerment?
For me, I think Mada Youth have been left behind. And that's one of the reasons that informed my thinking for us to have such an event. It's unfortunate. I grew up to do student unionism and the rest of them. with so many people, so many youth in Nasarawa State that today are well placed and can do things for their communities and their people. And I give example, the present chairman of NASEC, for a youth to serve as chairman of NASEC to conduct the local government elections in Nasarawa State, it's a big position. And that happens to be somebody of my age group and somebody I related very well with when we're doing student unionism. The likes of Barrister Diko S.A.N. San, who was also the president of Nasarawa State Students Association today. He's a San. And the likes of Honorable Diko, that was chairman of Kefi Local Government, and you can go on and on. But today, when you look back in Madaland, you can hardly count Mada youth that have been able to attain one position or the other through mentorship by our elders or our elites and contribute positively or contribute to the development of Made Nation and development of Made youth. And for me, I think Made youth should take the center stage right now. We have only been, let's say we push the car during politics. We are never the drivers. We're never participants when it comes to decision making in politics in Made Nation. But just like our paper presenter said, we have to be involved in these things. All the users for the negative aspect, like Togri and the rest of it. We are the strength when it comes to politics. We snatch the ballot boxes. We do all the electioneering hard work. We're the ones that carry the hand. Formed this decision. And like I tell a lot of people, I don't even celebrate appointments anymore in Madaland. I must be frank, and I'm saying this publicly. Because if we're supposed to celebrate appointments today, those appointments should reflect to benefit, just like the guest speaker said. If I'm a commissioner today, if I'm a chairman, if I'm whatever, what have I brought back to my people? Have I created job opportunities? Have I empowered them? It's pathetic. I know so many of our Made youth that have dropped out of their master's program. If your father is not rich today, you can't even do master's in Madeland. You know what it costs to do master's.
If your father is not rich and you are not determined, and you drop out.
Even there are those that are determined, but you don't have the resources. I know sometimes those that we have rallied around to raise resources for them to pay fees to write exams, they can't even pay the fees for their master's program. It's quite pathetic and it's disturbing.
They can't pay the fees. Don't you think it's part of laziness on their part? But I will not want you to answer that when we come to Dr. Bashai. Maybe he will give us the solution to that. Yeah. However, you are the driver of the Made youth, and you're talking of not being satisfied with their level of engagement in politics. What are you doing to change this narrative as the driver of Made youth?
This event is one of it, because we're trying to create an awareness amongst our youths. And for those who feel this event is not important, they are watching us live on YouTube and Facebook. And the honest truth is that our future, our progress, our development has to do with politics. We can't get good roads if we don't participate in politics. We can't get job opportunities. Right now, we don't even have people to run to when we're looking for jobs. Vacancies come, we apply, but you don't even see Made youth being shortlisted. We can't get good health care if we don't participate in politics. So a lot of awareness is going to be created, and we're going to go district by district to educate our youth. Made youth must speak with one voice come 2023. The tribe must rise up and save the future of our unborn children. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Comrade Kuni John Omaru, the National President of Made Youth Development.
Sorry, I don't know if you can permit to mention one important point I left out.
We'll still come back to you. And to you, Mrs. Comrade Mrs. Salome John Bicha, Yes, the president was talking of the youth, and you are representing my own constituency, which is the ladies. I'm glad that we have the forum of Mada ladies here in the house. Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied with the level of engagement of Mada women, Mada ladies in politics, governance, thereby contribute to nation building?
Mada, say girl, who the songs come made that said you will go, Mada, Zuma wish you. Well, go, Mada, I will look like Mutan and Mada, Zuma wish you. Go, go, Mada, I'm the Latin and Mada, Zuma wish you.
Though it's allowed in the studio, we could switch here. You can speak any language that you want. We all understand.
Well,
we are Mada people, so we are proud that she is representing us. You can flow in Mada, you can flow in Hausa, you can flow in English. I give you the permission, ma'am.
With due recognition to our Ibira president, I started intentionally. This is a Mada youth gathering. And I noticed that since we stepped into this place, no one spoke Mada. It was a great challenge to me. Thank you very much for this opportunity to sit before these wonderful people. I love my people. Funny enough, I'm not married to Mada. People hear and ask me, if you so loved Mada, why did you marry outside Mada? And I tell them one thing, I stayed old at home because I wanted to marry Mada, but Mada men lacked courage to face me. Yes. They lacked courage to face me.
Please, a round of applause for her, if that is what you ladies are facing.
I met plenty men in my life who came my way, but the bold ones with the kind of intelligence I like were out of the motherland. I am not trying to speak ill of my people, my brothers, but I am trying to portray what our speaker said earlier. I sat down there while he was speaking and I was weeping in my heart. When I arrived at Kwanga last night, I spoke with the president and I said a lot to him within a very short time that we're together. I told him how I faced my own brother and was challenging them concerning the happenings in motherland. Some of them turned and said they wished I was a man. I said, no, even as a woman, I will do what I need to do. Now, bouncing back to
my question.
Your question. Well, talking of satisfaction on the participation of women in politics or nation building, well, there is no satisfaction at all.
Why?
Because if we are to talk about women in politics, there is no how we can talk about that without remembering, sorry, I'm not a historian, no, a political student, but I will do a little justice to what I am saying, without taking us back to the Beijing conference in the 80s. When the women came together, that was when the awareness started. The awareness started, and a lot embraced it in the African countries. Focusing in Nigeria, you know, is it the national agenda, what do they call it? When the Beijing conference started, when they came together, they made a pronouncement, or rather a declaration on women participation in politics in Nigeria, or all over, women participation generally. But the awareness came to Nigeria, Nigerians accepted it. That was where it all began.
And let me remind you that what gave birth to that Beijing conference is due to the marginalization of women.
Thank you
that
very much.
Women decided to gather in Beijing,
yes,
and form a common front to see to the liberation of women politically, educationally, and otherwise.
Exactly. So all of that started, you know, the affirmative action proposal was 30%. 35%. They demanded for, okay, not 30, 30% when they met in Beijing, the requirement was 30%. But it was the instant gender something that came together and said, no, instead, let it be 35%. And ever since, that has been glamoring, what everybody is glamoring for every now and then. But are we still, are we there yet? The answer is no. I know that the government is trying its best, and even groups and NGOs are trying their best towards the inclusiveness of women in politics participation in Nigeria. They are doing their best, but that best is not good enough. Looking at it in this, our land, we cannot talk about us without talking of our mothers. Since my inception in this state, I've known just one or two women who have been part of the politics of the motherland. When I was in the university, I know Mrs. Mazunche, she was a commissioner. After that,
that is Charity Mazunche.
Okay, I don't know her first name. Then the second person is Haji Arabi, here with us. Besides those two people, I don't know, many of you know better than I do here, but based on my knowledge, they are the two women I've known to be part of the politics in motherland, so-called state politics. Looking at our state assembly, how many women, right from the inception of 1999 to 2001, were part of the state assembly? Or House of Reps from Nasarawa, or the Senate? You can look at it that before the pre-colonial period, women were somehow carried along. They were part of the administrators. They handled businesses. But during the colonialism, things changed. They now all turned into business, just focusing in businesses. They now left politics to the men. Now, to me, I saw it as part of the strategy of the colonial master. And the women fell into that system. They became victims. And ever since, things have not changed, despite the agitations here and there. Okay, let's agree that women are carried away partially. What about here in motherland? I am glad to meet you. We started a forum sometimes in 2014, the Mother Daughters, I mean League of Mother Daughters. Then I was busy doing my unionism. The lady we put in charge felt she could not have the, you know, boldness to face people here and there. The next to her, some of them got married and just left everything. We did our best to bring them together, all to no avail. You know, but it is a good thing for the mother lady or woman to know her place in the society.
But don't you think that it is because of some factors, maybe the cultural factors, that is limiting them?
Yes, I am going there. You know, our system generally has relegated the woman to the background. Talking about the culture, religion, and other little factors here and there. Okay, for instance, marriage. In this motherland, there are some of us who men stood against due to this little reason that we are married outside mother. But I know that the Federal Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria has given me the right to choose where I want to contest for an election. I have this dual citizenship. If I want to, if I think that I've gathered my arsenal in my fatherland, I am free to do so. I went to contest for MDA election at a point in time. They said I was not married to mother. The man spoke mother. I told him. I was only making jib on mother. That was my response. So that is unchangeable. Now, looking at religion, because I am coming from the aspect of Christianity, I understand that that is Christianity. Do you know if I'm a pagan or a Muslim? I know that Islamically, a woman can choose to bear her father's name all through her life, because I believe it that it is attached to somehow what I said earlier. So, looking at all these things, many of our women lack the courage to keep pushing after all these discouragements. When that happened, I still refused to give up until they refused to screen me, knowing that if I was screened, nothing was going to stop me from winning. You know, so women are not given their space in the society due to, paramountly to me, the culture and religion.
I think some people are against this, your defense, because they believe that women are the architects of their problem. Do you think that the Mada women are ready to take over, looking at the change mantra that is going on now, to see that women have a voice in the society? How prepared are the Mada women to change this?
We are ever ready to change the narrative. I hope the ladies in the room are hearing her. I believe that is what brings about this motivation for these beautiful ladies to be seated right here. I believe so. Sorry, what did you say?
I said, do you think they are ready to change?
Of course, yes.
Okay.
Not that. You asked something earlier.
How prepared and okay. How ready are they?
Of course, I believe the Mada woman is always ready. A Mada woman is known to be a very strong woman. Our mothers are very strong. We are not weak in any way. Wherever I find myself, I'm proud to be a Mada lady. There is no Mada woman anywhere. Look at them, even those who are outside. They seem to be the engine of the house in every aspect. Wherever we go, we represent very well. In fact, my in-laws told me they are coming back because they need more of my time. Yes, I'm a good representative and I'm proud of it. A lady got married last Saturday and I got to know that she's a Mada lady from Akwanga. I went to her, she didn't know me. I said, now you have to know that you are an ambassador. Go and represent us very well. She looked at me. I said, I'm Mada too. And she smiled. I said, please don't do anything that people will turn and say, Mada girls, don't do it. Make sure you respect your in-laws, do the needful, and all will be well. So talking about we taking charge, we are ready. But what we lack is the support from our parents, from our brothers, and the men around. Okay. Women are not given this opportunity. Instead, when we go seeking for such opportunities, what comes our way is men trying to take advantage of us, forgetting that we are their sisters and we need them. I really don't understand. I feel perhaps they don't want us to be free from poverty, because they know that if we have the resources in our hands, they cannot stand. Now, what I expect us to do as brothers and sisters is to always have the back of each other. But that is lacking. The speaker spoke, he said a lot. In fact, I sat and wished this hall was full to capacity. It is quite disheartening to see that such an event is happening, a whole Mada Youth National. Where are the youths? Such an educative program, they are nowhere to be found. Look at the few of us seated here. It is a pity, my brothers. Now, the speaker even spoke and said, this change that we are talking about has to begin with us. Now, let's start it this simple. When coming here, how many people did you invite to this place? Was it that the publicity was poor, that the hall is so empty? Be part of it, because what I heard here today has given me a transformation. As for me, I will not go back there and remain the same.
All right. Thank you very much, Comrade Mrs. Salumi. We're talking about Mada Youth participation in politics.
governance and economic empowerment. And the youth president said that some youth dropped out of school because of lack of financial support. Now, the representative of the women, which is Comrade Mrs. Salumi, is talking about a lack of economic empowerment for the women. We now go to our business consultant. What is the way forward for us in Madaland, especially the youth and the women?
What is the way forward? Thank you for that question. I have told John most often than not when we meet that economic power precedes political power. When you call people for political meeting, you buy coke for them, Abi. Coke is sold in naira and kobo, so somebody has to pay. When we don't have economic liberation, even politically, we're limited. When I come home for weekends to see my parents sometimes, I see young guys, well-dressed, they're graduates, they went to school, but no jobs. They come to see me, hey, how far? We came for courtesy call, all right? And I'm not a politician. I work in the private sector. I've been in the private sector all my life. I only understand how things work in the private sector. So when I see a job opportunity, I say, guys, apply for this. They don't even take it serious because the system they are used to is go and bring appointment letter, take.
White collar jobs, always.
White collar job. And I don't have access to it. For you to be employed in the private sector, you have to apply. Somebody will interview you. You will need to prove yourself. Then you get hired. Then you work for what you earn. All right? I had to step out to attend the meeting because today is a work day. I am still at work. Now, the point I am trying to make is that when we want to become politically aware, we need to find a system that helps our youth to be financially liberated. There are no hard and fast rules about it. The reason why the politician can put you in his pocket is because he pays the bills. So you go line up in his house, he comes on 50K, give 50 of you, you share 1K, and you go, and you start hailing him. That's why we cannot hold them accountable. Dr. Jastro talked about it, that we can hold our leaders accountable, right? How do we hold somebody that gives us money for Harka Agari? How do we hold him accountable? You just left his house, just give you some cash, and you now want to turn back and go and start saying, make it a good move. How do you think that's going to work?
At least he has shared the money with you.
But you cannot have a conscience to challenge him.
That is what I'm trying to say.
All right? So this is the point. When you feed me, I can't challenge you in public or even in private. Because there is a conscience that I've sold out. So when guys are working small, small jobs and earning a small money that they can feed themselves, they can stand up and say, you don't feed me, I can tell you the truth that nothing will happen. All right? So I can face any political person today and I can tell him my mind. He doesn't feed me. The worst that he can do is to block the road to our house. Then I will find another place and go and live. All right? So we need to find a system that empowers our youth financially. And we cannot do this by our youth just being lazy and answering yes and doing boy, boy all the time. We can do something. If the people who are doing boy boy can decide that we will find something to do with our hands and not go and line up with the house of every politician, we know when they come for weekends. We know everything about them. We are the cycle fans singing their praises even when they are doing wrong. No. Somebody has to stand up and say, this is not good. It's not because the guy is giving you money, you can no longer say your mind. Of course, you can't say your mind because you're collecting money from him, right? So what then do we do to ensure that you have some cash in your pocket that when you go and tell him your mind and he doesn't give you transport money, you have transport to go home? That's what we should be focusing on. So when we have programs like this, this is the kind of mindset you get. The fact that this hall is this scanty is the problem we're dealing with. You're trying to discuss serious issues, they won't show up. Organize a beauty pageant now. This place, you will sell tickets and it will be sold out. Because the things that trick their, that appeal to their imagination, their consciences, are not serious issues. So they would rather wait and be collecting and collecting and collecting, bah, 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 bah. So nobody's taking responsibility for his own action. The job you're doing now, who gave you? Do you understand? You worked for it. You went to school, studied hard, and you tried your best to make some headway in life. You're taking responsibility for yourself. But somebody just sitting down and say, bah, 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 yeah, Zambi. There is a place for the people who have gone ahead of you to pave the way. But there's also a place for your own diligence to also ensure you're following. If I say, go and write an aptitude test, if you fail, how is it my fault? Right? You did not go and prepare. Others were reading past questions, trying to do something to get serious with it. You went and slept all through and came back the next day and say, I am Papa, so Irukuni, I'm Gabanchi, Muyandasana State, I'm Chile, Mwachiki, Lizavi.
Okay, Dr. Bashaye, I think we can even go beyond this issue of waiting for aptitude tests, waiting for employment. I think the world has now turned digital. You can even sit in your room and make money. So, what must the Imada youth do to ensure that they are empowered economically? Instead of waiting for white collar jobs.
I will say, number one is to start taking responsibility for ourselves. You know, they say you can force a horse to the river, you can't force it to drink water. Even if I get you a job, if you don't work well, they'll fire you. That will no longer be my fault. So number one, take responsibility for yourself. Number two, when the opportunities come, make the most of it, right? Today, we have people who can buy data and do WhatsApp and Facebook. I told some young people when I was talking on an entrepreneurship session, I said, do you know that you can sell on your phone without owning even goods? Go and take pictures of somebody who sells shoes in a Kwanga market, put it on your WhatsApp status. When they click and say, oh, I like this shoe, how much is it, 5K? The guy selling in a Kwanga market sells it for 4K. You say, bring a 5K. You collect the 5K from the lady, run to a Kwanga market, spend 100 naira or 200 naira as TP. Go and collect the shoe and come and deliver. You have made 800 naira. You don't need to own the shop. You don't need to keep the inventory. You don't even need to have working capital. But we have the data, and only God knows what we use the data for. Right? And we want angels to fall from heaven and start throwing manners. Those days are past. There's no free lunch, even in Freetown. Somebody has to pay. And if you don't make the money, you won't pay the bills. So, both men and women. So, if a man goes looking for something, they say, bring money. If a girl goes looking for something, they say, bring your body. And if you don't have what it takes, if a girl does not have brain and does not have money, it's her body that will suffer. Somebody has to exchange something for something. So we go and they say they want to take advantage of you. Of course, that's the only thing you have to offer. Your body is the only thing you have to offer. So why wouldn't they collect it? Somebody needs to exchange it for value. So I'm sorry I'm speaking as passionate as I'm saying. Because this whole program that was organized, John has spent money. It will be a waste if nobody takes responsibility for his own, takes responsibility for his own action and does something about it. We'll come back next year and have this rhetoric. It will end up at talk. We need to start walking the talk. When I say somebody should come and rear rabbits, I have a job, a regular 9 to 5 o'clock job, but I rear rabbits in my house so that I can have another stream of income. Even if you have to chop the rabbits, it will be good for my body too. But you tell a young guy who is a graduate now, he'll tell you are working where they gave you car. And I'm saying, find me a job. You're saying I should go and rear rabbits. He's already seen that you're demeaning him. He's not seen the dignity in the fact that I made 5 naira honorably. It's better than 100 naira dashed to me. That's the problem. And if we do not think that economic liberation is a serious matter, we can as well forget the political part. because one precedes the other. We can use our numbers, but once small stomach is involved, hunger. Hunger day, you betray your brother because of your stomach.
Moreover, they said a hungry man is an angry man.
Exactly.
And it was because of hungry that Esau sold his birthright.
So hungry now. So in that result. So when people are hungry, the only thing, the only language you understand is food at that time. It's after we have sold ourselves and we are now full. When I say, hey, may cook a chair, and the show has finished. You've sold it, it's gone. So let's focus on finding a way to liberate ourselves financially and economically. It does not matter whether it's big or small, there's dignity in labor. Some years ago, I just made this last comment and then I'll be done. When happy hour, when Chivita started making happy hour, that one that comes in the 1 liter pack, they used to sell it 1,000 naira in Maraba hold up on your way to Abuja. So a carton has 10 packs, right? So they'll put 5 in transparent nylon and sell it for 1,000. The whole carton then used to be 1,500. So you buy 1,500 and sell it 2,000 and make 5,500 naira profit. 500 naira profit of an investment of 1,500 is 33.33%. Not so many businesses in Nigeria make 33% margin. Make no mistakes about it. So these guys will go and buy and go and sell. My friend used to work in Chivita Depot in Kefi, which covers the Maraba axis. He said there's a guy that comes to buy 20 cartons from them every day. He makes 500 naira times 20. That is how much? 10,000 per day. So if he works for 6 days in a week, let's say he's a Christian and goes to church on Sunday, 60,000 naira per week, 240,000 per month. There are many of us sitting here that don't earn 240k per month. In fact, there are some people that if they earn 240k per month, they will get it as title. And they are the ones that everybody will bring invitation letter for wedding, for child dedication, for because they earn big money, 240k. Wow, a lot of cash. But this guy, nobody even remembers to send an invitation letter to him. Because but he's a rich guy. Even the shirt he's wearing was donated to him by Chibita, so he doesn't go buy shirts. So he can save 100k a month and buy land. And you are here, can I choose on Suru? You don't even market a market in 5k. So you see, you think the guy is a bad guy. Maybe he's a graduate that has had to humble himself and earn a decent living. You think he's suffering. Why won't he cross his leg in front of his father's TV and just watch his way around things? But he has chosen not to do that, but to earn a legitimate living. And you are thinking he's the one suffering, while you are the one that is suffering. So people must wake up and do the most menial job that is decent, that can bring 5 naira. Yafi babu. Look around you, do something that can bring some little income. It is when you can feed yourself that somebody cannot tell you rubbish and go. But when you cannot feed yourself, you are a slave to the person that gives you food.
May we never become slaves to the people that will give us food. To you, I'm tempted to call you CP, maybe because it's coming on the way. SP Yerima, we talked about the youth, the women, and the entrepreneurship. Now, without all these things, or when all these issues that we discuss have issues, it tempers with our security. And when the security is tempered, it also affects the existing peace that we are enjoying in Akwanga local government area, Nasarawa state, and the relative peace that we have in Nigeria. What role do you think the Mada youth, both at home and in the diaspora, have to sustaining or promoting security in their respective domain?
Thank you. Security generally is to protect and defend, to make sure our people sleep with their two eyes closed. If there's no peace, there's a problem. There's no peace, You can move from one community to another. You can travel. You can't go anywhere. Your life is in danger. You either survive or death. It's everybody's business. And when we can, we discover and we have to apply and re-strategize to make sure our brothers in our Kwanga have peace. Between the border of Nasarawa Egon and Akwanga, Akwanga Wamba, Akwanga going to Kaduna State, Akwanga and Garaku will make sure we adopt a system we in person as the head and make sure I deploy about this system. I deploy a fixed route system. We also have a Bogo informer. We have special informer. We have a reward informer. You as a citizen, as people in person, you will not know. And that is why Akwanga today is peace. We are not supporting youth, the radical. We are not supporting youth to become something else. So we only educate and advise that there should be peace. Without peace, there will be no business. And that is why we apply these systems. And today, we are here. And we must continue adopt it. And continue lecture people that peace is the only way. And you can stay and do any other thing you want to do on earth. Thank you.
Okay, let me talk to Hausa now. When you roll one, you can gang mata some mother suke the she does as ear taka kuski takawa dumb gun chi waman tapatas the zaman lapia the kuma batun saru she one local government now. Do you think they have any role to play in ensuring peace and promotion of security in a Kwanga local government?
As I've said earlier, we have Bogo informer, and they are youth.
Okay.
We have road informer, they are youth. We have special informer, they are youth.
They are all youth.
They are youth. So if they pass information to us, telling us that something is happening in so-so place, we swim into the action immediately.
So are you comfortable with their level of engagement or involvement in security of this local government and the state at large?
Yes, their involvement in youth. If you turn around, you discover that we have vigilante. They are youth. We have hunters. Some of them are youth. And they involve in the security to make sure that they protect the land.
And the same thing they said, all the criminal activities, or most of them, and other issue of insecurity are being carried out by the youth. Now you're sitting here representing Akwanga Divisional Office. What will be your advice to the youth that involve in all manner of activities that are uncalled for?
If you commit, no space in the law that permits that you must go free, you must be punished. No youth is advised to use violence or engage in an act of manner that will not go well.
All right. Thank you very much to Dr. Emmanuel Bashai, your advice to Mada youth and the youth of Nasarawa State, as well as Nigeria as a whole, on this issue of entrepreneurship, since it's the in thing now in the society.
So your question is, what's my advice, right?
Yes, your advice to the youth.
I think I've said quite a lot of it. Okay. Be productive. They say the idle mind is a devil's workshop. It's when you don't have anything you're doing that your friends can drag you, let's go and rob the house, and then his team that are so effective across the place will grab you, right? So security is a key issue for us, because if we have everybody busy, they will have less time for crime. And then there will be relative peace for all of us to sleep with our two eyes closed, right? So for me, my first advice is, nothing is small. Don't wait for the big job. It will come. But be busy doing something.
Start small.
Start small. Even when you're looking at value, right? Our speaker, Dr. Jacho, talked about earlier about getting skills and all. Get relevant skills. I have a friend. He's a data scientist. He's into artificial intelligence and a couple of these data science. He earns 4 million naira per month salary. And you know, it doesn't look like he's even working, but the sense he has and the knowledge he has, somebody's paying for it. So, first, be happy to engage in something as menial as possible. It has more dignity than begging. Number two, seek out opportunities actively, something you can do. Don't wait for opportunities to come to you, look for them. Some of you have uncles that have car. Uncle, can I come and be washing your car? Give me 5K at the end of the month. You know, pass, uncle, dash me 5K. That your uncle will not be wondering, what did you do for me that I'm giving you 5K? I'm washing your car. It's legitimate. I'm not stealing your money, right? When I was in the university as an undergraduate, I went to APU's area. I was staying in Suleiman Hall on the main campus. I was polishing shoe for undergraduates. Total cost of investment, 300 naira. Buy polish, buy small brush and big brush. We men always forget to buy polish. It's what we want to go out. I will not remember the shoe is dusty. Guys, shame not true. We'd always forget. So I saw a business opportunity there. So I bought polish and brush, because I normally have my own. My friends will come and use it and they won't pay. And I said, this is a good business. So I posted posters in Suleiman Hall. Come. Okay. Come and polish your shoe between 6:30 and 7:30 a.m. I was in 300 level. My first lecture starts at 8 o'clock. So when you come, I will give you the brush and the polish. Polish your shoe, then pay me 10 naira. Why would I polish your shoe? I'm an undergraduate like you now. No, you polish the shoe, you pay me. Sense. 5 naira enough photocopy material, because I always had change, 10 naira, 5 naira. It was having value that time, not now that it doesn't have value. So I had a small sense of business. And I can tell you, I went to some of the best business schools in the world. I learned more about business, running that small business, than any concept taught me in any business school I went to. If you want to insult me, now me get the money. So talk your own, I get cash. So when we have pride that we're not willing to do small things, does it look like I polish you to make money when I was in school? Do I look it today? No, we've passed that stage. Today I use that sense to do other bigger businesses. I do stuff now that the small sense I learned that time is helping me
I now know how to keep records. So I knew how much I was spending on polish. I knew how much I was changing or spending on replenishing brushes. So I learned inventory management. Do you understand? I now know how many shoes one tin of polish can polish. That was small sense I was learning. So I was managing inventory, I was managing turnover. Is that not what they teach in business school? Uh-huh. And I learned managing my shoe polishing business. If there's some other graduates here to do it, they will say, we haven't done it. I just taught you now, don't polish your shoe yourself. Let them polish it, but they should pay you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Emmanuel Bashayi. We are gradually coming to the end of this discussion. To you, our comrade, Mrs. Salumi, what advice or call do you have for the women folk of Mada? And looking at it, that when we're talking of youth, people used to think that youth is just the male folk of the youth that constitute the Mada youth. What advice do you have for them and even the stakeholders in the issue of supporting the women to see that they realize their full potentials?
Thank you very much. Well, my advice to the young women is to remain focused, never to give up despite challenges. Like our speaker said, life can never be without challenges. So I want us to utilize those challenges to take the steps anyways. Take the step anyway. Despite that, never give up. And for the stakeholders, we want to plead with them to give us the platform to function. All we need is the platform. Just as one of our early writers will say, give me the tools and I will finish the job. That is all the woman needs. That is all she needs, the platform to function. We urge them to always not see us as weaker vessels. We are not weak. We can do beyond they can even imagine. Just give us a try. When opportunities come, remember that you have sisters that you can give room to do something. And you should know that the society is not favorable to the girl child. Therefore, she needs you, the father, the brother, the uncle, to pave the way for her. When there are opportunities to give appointive positions, consider the daughter. When there is opportunity to vote into position, consider the daughter. She can do very well, only with your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Only with your support can we do better. Moreover, you can have a woman at home as a wife, a mother, a sister, or a daughter. So always support the woman to realize her full potential. To you, our host, the organizer of this program, the chief servant of Mada Youth, what are we expecting after this summit? Looking at all that has been discussed, what should the Mada Youth and other people out there expect from Mada Youth Week?
Okay, I want to send a message across on behalf of Mada Youth. And I want our leaders to know that we're now agents of change. We're not going to be available to be used and abandoned. You not use us for politics and abandon us. You must give us jobs. You must create an enabling environment for us to strive. It's pathetic that when you go through the streets of Opanga, Tik and Aha Road, Lafia Road, Kefi Road, and the rest of them, you see business ventures. People are making money here. A friend told me that there are businessmen in Opanga, genuine businessmen that own shops here. Igbos, houses that have as much as 500 million naira in their accounts. These are the wealth that people are making here. Mother youths must not be lazy. I'm happy to see people. Like, but they are exploring. Learn how to install CCTV cameras. I installed CCTV and I learned on my own. Nobody trained me. Today, I can couple a desktop system for you. I can buy all the components and couple them. I didn't do computer science or engineering. From CCTV alone, I know I have made nothing less than 5-10 million naira from CCTV jobs that I've gotten. Today I'm a surveyor. I sell shawarma. I sell ice cream. JK Palms here. It's a family venture. And I took opportunity of it. I saw kids coming and I said, no, it's an exploration. It's an avenue to get little profits. I have an ice cream machine in Kefi. I brought it here. From sales of ice cream machine alone, I got the money that we're doing even this program today. Because it's pathetic that no mother man Mothermen failed to support us. But I'm happy people like Sylvia Jasper, whenever we run to them, these are amongst the few. And then Chief Mike Abdul, that is always there to support us, like this, all that we're using for the event. But you'll be surprised at how we're able to put all these things together. So there are a lot of opportunities. You can think outside the box and you can make money. Lucky today is into ICT. What we're doing today here, doing this live streaming, is something that can cost somebody up to 200,000 to get it done. But we're doing it at almost no cost. So I want to advise our youth that you must not wait for white collar jobs. And we've seen some of these challenges. I'm happy with people like Dr. Jaco, Professor Shedrack. We're working on a template for we're trying to see how we can support MADA youth academically to read wide and also to study wide. So a lot is going to change in MADA land starting from now. All we need is the cooperation of MADA youths, and the sky is going to be our limit. Today you find out that most of this POS business, we've done our research, most of this POS business are being set up by even a politician for people that are not even of MADA extraction, but will be left behind. Like the speaker said, people do for their own. We have politicians today that can say, okay, I'm going to set up a business for maybe LJ today, and I say, I'm giving you 2 trailer loads of cement. We get a shop for you. Within 2 years, we return the money given to you. And we know how much you can make from a trailer of cement. If he does a turnover, he's going to be a major distributor in Akwanga. Set up somebody that will be distributor of Chivita. You're not giving him this money free. After 2 years, return the capital and we sort of another person. These are ways, but our politicians don't think that way. Set up somebody in ICT. If today you can go through Oracle training, you have your certified Oracle expert, you know what you're going to make just servicing banks. Banks alone. So if you're just back and bear me witness, from GIS alone in survey, you can be a multi-millionaire. GIS. So we're also trying to work with the groups of people like Lucky to train people in ICT. But I'm telling you, we've made contacts. Nobody is forthcoming. Just to support these younger ones with training. Training. We can't even get leaders in Motherland that can support such training. But we'll do it ourselves. We'll do it ourselves. We're going to change the narrative. And I'm pleading, Mother Youth, let's come together and synergize. Today, you hear people from other clients, young people vying for House of Reps, Assembly, and the rest. How many of us today can contest election? Akasa Mada as youths. Couldn't form Kawe. Who? So we really have to rise up to the challenge before this tribe goes into extinction. So I want to appreciate all of us for coming, and our Ankara, thank you for the injustice. So I think I've answered you.
All right, thank you, Mr. President. You are not to round up the show for me. Like in the words of Dr. Jacko, he said, in the march to greatness, politics is very critical. And Dr. Emmanuel Bashai said, economic empowerment is critical. But from me, in the march to greatness, putting into use what you have heard today, what you have learned, and what you have seen today is inevitable. Therefore, make the most of this opportunity to change the narrative for Mada Nation, for Mada Youth, Nasarawa States, and Nigeria as a whole. We hope that you enjoy this discussion. I hope that next year we'll still gather here to discuss on an important issue that will forge the course of Mother Nation. And this will be the size of our discussion. Thank you so much for investing your time with us. And to our discussant, Comrade Kuni John Umaru, thank you so much. Comrade Mrs. Salome Mbucha John, we really appreciate your company. And to SP Yerima, our CP in waiting, we cannot thank you enough. To Dr. Obashai, our business consultant, we hope to have you next time. Thank you so much for coming on the program. And to you, our listeners and our viewers, thank you so much for investing your time with us. Always do the needful for the cause of Mada Nation. I remain your uncle, Patience Jacob. Many thanks for investing your time with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At this juncture, she has said it earlier, we are almost at the end of this very gathering. So behind the microphone, I would love to call the chief host of this very great program to come for the vote of thanks. Thank you, sir.
Our paper presenter, Savio Jasper, the VP of Okwanga Local Government, my fellow comrade, Comrade Ohimege. I want to thank each and every one of us for making our time to be here. We might just be a few here, but I want to assure you that what we have achieved today, what we have achieved today cannot be measured. And I want to assure you that we're going to work tirelessly to make sure that we move forward as youths and also develop our nation for a better tomorrow. All I want is your cooperation. I'm not here today as president of MDA Youth Wing for any image making, no. But I'm here because I want a future for our youth and for our children. So let us kick the message out there and preach oneness, preach unity, preach Mada, and say no to leaders that are not productive. So thank you, and God bless you all as we go back to our various destinations. Tomorrow we'll be going to Numan Hills for hiking. So if you're interested, you join us. We'll go up the hill. My brother, Honorable John Madala, hope you join us with Madam. No, Madam cannot go. I know. Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you. Break it down. At this juncture, we've started with God, and I want us to end with prayer, not to even end with God. Okay, at this juncture, behind the microphone, I would like to call our Abby. Please, you can do the closing prayer for us. Thank you. Let's listen attentively for the closing prayer, please.
In Jesus' name, Heavenly Father, we thank you. We glorify your name. We worship you for everything you've done in our midst. Thank you for the opportunity given to us to gather here once again. We want to say your name be highly exalted in Jesus' name. Father, we'll bring to you, Lord, that all that we've heard here, that will be good ambassadors of it out there in the name of Jesus. And as we retire back to our various homes, Father, may you go with us in the name of Jesus. Take glory, take adoration, for in Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you. Thank you.